Some of the things that get the most cold are your hands. And when your hands get cold at times, it's tough to really get good spin on a breaking ball. So we'll see how this day goes. If you feel really cold, sometimes you have to go to more of a fastball changeup situation rather than really relying on your breaking ball. But in the 40s right now, and as you look at the flags, there's not much wind blowing at all. I feel like you should be able to throw your whole repertoire of pitches. When it gets into the 20s and 30s, which it could be on Sunday, that's when it can get difficult to really feel that baseball and command the baseball where you want to.
So we're ready to go. Ethan Small, the 6'3 lefty junior from Lexington, Tennessee. We'll lead off facing Matt Odom, the center fielder for Sam Houston State, senior from Klein, Texas, in the Houston area. First pitch in the 2019 Frisco Classic is underway. Odom, this is just his second official at bat this season. He does have a hit and two runs scored.
Watch for Sam Houston State as they squirt around early, that they can get on by small ball early in the game by bunting.
And does so there. Small unable to handle it. And that's a leadoff single off the bunt by Odom.
Man, I feel like Tony Romo right there calling the bunt right before it happens. And Sam Houston State getting on base to start this game. And this was a pretty good bunt. And when you're going against a left-handed pitcher, as you see Small falling off to the third base side, you try to bunt the ball the first base side, and it worked out perfectly for Sam Houston.
When it's so cold like this, does small ball become even more important?
It can be, because obviously if you get jammed or something, it's going to bug your hands, and being able to bunt the ball, put the ball in play, and put the pressure on the defense can be very important.
Now Riley McKnight, senior from Spring, Texas. An 0-1 count to McKnight. You'll recognize, as we introduce the Sam Houston State players all game long, a Texas flair. In fact, all but one player on the entire Bearcat roster is from the state of Texas. Huntsville, Texas, where Sam Houston State is located, about an hour northwest of the Houston area. So many of these players playing their high school ball in the greater Houston area before making their way to Huntsville.
It has to feel good that when you're playing on a college team, you still feel like you have a little bit of the high school feel, because you know pretty much all the cities that all your teammates are from.
So Riley McKnight batting 143. Throw to first, gets McKnight, but he moves the runner over.
Good bunt there. I don't know if he was bunting just for a sacrifice, but it works out well. I'm sure they would have loved to get another hit out of that, but gets the leadoff runner to second base and runner in scoring position with less than two outs. Always a good way to start off a game.
So of all the talented players that Sam Houston State has, maybe the most effusive praise from their head coach, Mac Deggs, was for this young man at the plate, Colton Kowser. He's just a freshman, also from the Houston area in Cypress. He's off to a tremendous start, 357 hitter on the young season. Runner going. Throw to third, tag applied in time. Odom tagged out.
Good job by Mississippi State with less than two outs, knowing that the runner's going to go. Always an easier throw for the catcher. Skelton there with a left-handed hitter there. Doesn't have to worry about the right-handed hitter. And good job by Small giving your catcher a chance to throw a guy out, and Odom was out by a good two or three steps.
So now the base is clear for Kowser. And a grounder to the first base side. Tanner Allen, three unassisted. And that'll do it for Sam Houston State. But single for Odom, but he's caught trying to steal third. And it'll be Mississippi State coming to bat when we return to Frisco. David Salzman, Mike Bassick with you from Frisco, Texas. Mississippi State about to come to the plate for the first time, and they'll face on the mound for Sam Houston State. A very good-looking junior from Cypress, Texas, standing tall at 6'3", Hayden Wesneski.
Yeah, Wesneski throws kind of three quarters, I won't say sidearm, but gets close to sidearm, throws the ball 91 to 93 miles an hour, a good changeup and a good breaking ball, which is getting his 21 strikeouts to only three walks this year in 13 and a third innings.
The Sam Houston State team that is 5-2 and lamenting a fog out on Wednesday at home when they led TCU 10-3 in the second inning. Would have been a great win on the resume, but because the game didn't go at least five, it does not count despite the Bearcat big lead. But they are here looking for a good couple of wins, at least in Frisco. You know, last season they played at the Shriners Classic at Minute Maid Park in Houston and knocked off Vanderbilt during the weekend. So Bearcats amongst the stiff competition here.
And Wisniewski comes out and he's throwing strikes, gets an 0-2 count. And you're talking about Sam Houston State. That's one of those schools where you don't think too much about because it's not a name like Mississippi State. But they have been putting together some really solid teams over the last few years and can be a threat again in a regional this season.
Jake Mangum at the plate for Mississippi State. Just a special young man, senior from Pearl, Mississippi. 288 career hits. 1-2 the count to Mangum.
We'll see after that high fastball about head high. Sometimes as a lefty going against a righty, sometimes you want to go a soft away a little bit down here and see if you can get him out in front.
Tried to paint the corner and just missed.
Yeah, tried to backdoor the breaking ball there and just missed. So he wanted to go outside just a little bit away and a little bit probably too high, but still in a favorable count as a pitcher here, 2-2.
Was Nesky's numbers, not zero walks, 24 strikeouts like his counterpart in Small, but coming in three walks and 21 strikeouts and 13 and a third innings pitched.
And he's coming in so far and looks really solid. He's really jamming Mangum here, and he's having trouble getting that bat head out. So this pitch, I will say, let's just go hard back inside and see if you can jam him or strike him out.
Mangum stays alive, still 2-2.
Good job by Mangum right now. He's just kind of battling, trying to slap that ball. It looks like the other way. If the ball gets inside on him, foul it off. Probably looking for something that he can inside out and hit the ball to the left side of the field and get a hit. And Sam Houston State right now is shaded oppo in the outfield.
Good snag, Wisniewski. One away.
Really good job fielding your position after making a quality pitch there, and not a bad at bat, even though it's just a 1-3 ground out, to be able to get to see six or so pitches in that first at bat is a decent at bat to start the game off. You'd love to get on base, but give your team an idea of what the pitcher has on the mound.
Mississippi State, the most runs they've given up in a game this year is four. Some extra pressure on Wisniewski coming in, especially going up against a talented young man in Ethan Small for the Bulldogs as Jordan Westberg fouls off the first offering to him. Westberg is the Mississippi State shortstop, batting .382 on the season. Sophomore from New Braunfels, Texas, about a four-hour drive south of here.
Getting ahead again, 0-2. You can do a lot of different things. That was a good sinker inside that caught the corner, and he can go to that again. He can try to elevate the ball right here.
Went
back to the sinker. And the other thing here is when you look at Westberg, and I wasn't paying attention too much to the first two pitches, but he's really choked up on the bat. Now, I don't know if that's his two-strike approach or if he was choking up that much early on in the count.
Got him.
Good breaking ball there. Gets his strikeout, 22nd of the season, first of the day. And right now, both pitchers look like they have command of their stuff early.
Such a potent Mississippi State lineup, including this young man, the first baseman, Tanner Allen. Freshman All-American last season by Collegiate Baseball, hit .287 last year and is at .324 in the young season here in 2019, including a couple of homers.
Well, right now, Hayden Wisniewski on the mound is getting ahead and staying ahead as he's 3-for-3 in first pitch strikes.
Texas Tech, Nebraska, our nightcap, set to start around 7 o'clock Central Time. To second, and Riley McKnight. 1-2-3, go down the Bulldogs in the first. Just getting underway here at the 2019 Frisco College Baseball Classic, Bearcats and Bulldogs. Two big reasons why this tournament goes on each and every year now. Number one is to showcase some of the best programs in all of college baseball, and certainly that's the case with the four teams that we have here in 2019. But also, money is raised through this tournament to benefit the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. Over $20,000 was raised last season. They're looking to exceed that amount here in 2019. We actually heard during the Frisco Classic breakfast, which was held at Baylor Scott and White Performance Center at the Star, the amazing work that the CF Foundation does for those who suffer from cystic fibrosis. It was just, you know, a couple of decades ago when those diagnosed with CF might not be able to make it to their 20s and 30s, and now so many more are living as close to a normal life as they can, married, family, living into their 60s and 70s. The amazing work that the CF Foundation does goes to support all those people who suffer from this disease. Go to FriscoClassic.com to learn more and to donate to the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. Scoreless, Sam Houston State, Mississippi State. As we start the top half of the second inning, here's the Bearcat first baseman, Hunter Hearn.
Fastball for a strike there, and that's only seven pitches. Six pitches and three outs, obviously a caught stealing in the first inning, but Ethan Small looks like he's off to a good start too. A little bit of a quick pitch right there if you saw from Ethan Small. No leg lift on that one. He's had different motion so far. I've seen the hesitation motion. That one was the first one where I've seen a quick pitch. So it looks like Ethan Small really tries to keep guys off balance by giving different motions with his leg lift. Saw the hesitation mm-hmm. there. That can be tough. But I mean, you usually as a pitcher, you want to get into a rhythm and a timing. And when you are doing quick leg lifts and then hesitation leg lifts, it really takes an athletic guy to do multiple things on the mound like that.
Breaking pitch, got him. Hearn is the first out.
Good changeup right there after throwing fastballs and set him up really nicely. As Ethan Small, as we can see, the 24 strikeouts to zero walks coming in is the real deal right there. He can throw multiple pitches over for strikes in different counts.
Clayton Harp at the plate is the reigning Southland Conference hitter of the week. Went 8-for-13 with three homers in a weekend sweep of the Raging Cajuns of Louisiana in Huntsville last weekend.
Both teams also so far, I know it's early on, we're only in the top of the second inning, but both teams are really aggressive swinging the bat early in the count. And on that one there, he's really blown by two fastballs right here. A little bit higher than the zone. That front leg here needs to get down a little bit sooner if he wants to try to catch up to those fastballs.
0-2. as a hitter, how hard is it to stay back when you see that hesitation in Small's windup as you just did?
It shouldn't be that hard unless you have a big left leg lift. So for Harp, who lifts his leg pretty high, it can get more challenging. I've listened to Josh Donaldson, who is now with the Braves for the Toronto Blue Jays, talk about it and talking about how he works that leg lift and when he has to try to get that foot down based off of the recognition of the pitch. And in this one, almost the recognition of motion, then recognition of pitch. There's the quick pitch right there where you see no leg lift and good try on the outer half of the plate, but it was outside. But Ethan Small's able to give right here as we see the quick pitch there, no leg lift. And this one might be the big hesitation or the normal. So he has three different motions out of the windup.
Inside.
He's staying up in the zone, which the first two pitches I would try to stay there too because he's behind on the count. I'm wondering if he doesn't want to maybe go to breaking ball here because Harp has been behind on the fastball and he doesn't want to give him a chance to get that bat head out and put the ball in play.
Called strike three. Second strikeout for Small, both this inning.
Unless you throw a good breaking ball and they don't swing at it right there. That was a good curveball right here, as you can see. Lefty on lefty, kind of starts at the shoulder. You see a little bit of the bell out on the lefty on lefty situation. That front shoulder goes out, and if that happens lefty on lefty, you have a great chance of being successful as a pitcher.
Jordan Cannon's the designated hitter for Sam Houston State, now at the plate. Senior from Centerville, Texas. A rare time that Small's gotten behind in the count so far today. If you're just joining us, Mac Odom reached on a bunt single to lead things off for the Bearcats in the first, but was thrown out trying to steal third, and that ended the threat in that first inning. Lifted to left, Rowdy Jordan there. A nice running grab by the Mississippi State left fielder. A 1-2-3 frame for Small, still scoreless in Frisco. The Frisco Classic is brought to you by Academy Sports. Visit your local academy or go online at academy.com to learn more. Early on still here in the second, but expecting a pitcher's duel coming in with these two young men and Ethan Small and Hayden Wesneski. Three walks allowed, 45 strikeouts combined. And so far, both looking good as we head to the bottom half of the second, Mike.
Yeah, and sometimes, you know, you get really excited to start a game and you have trouble finding your rhythm in the first inning. A lot of times there's stats that'll say that first inning, the fifth inning, and the seventh inning are times where you can really get to starting pitchers. Well, in this game, it had nothing to do with the first inning. Both guys came ready to pitch and really show their best stuff early on in this game. And it looks like, as a pitcher, you watch this and you say, okay, I'm going to have to match zeros. This is probably a game where there's not going to be big innings, so I need to go out there and really be on my game every pitch.
Talked about the number of Bearcats from the Houston area. The man leading off from Mississippi State, also from the Houston area, and Elijah McNamee. Play for Cowser on to first in time. One pitch, one out.
Good three-quarters sinker right there, and like all the batters, not just Mississippi State, there's been 10 batters and they're all coming up ready to hack, and as a pitcher, you know, I'm going to be aggressive, good first pitch strikes, and I can get some quick outs in this game.
Mississippi State 8-1 on the season. Their only loss, a game in which their ace Ethan Small pitched. There was a 1-0 loss to Southern Miss last Friday in 10 innings. First pitch strike to Justin Foscue, the Bulldog third baseman.
It's 5 for 5 on first pitch strikes. That's a really important stat from pitching coaches if you're going to be successful or not in a game.
Now a 1-1 count to Foscue, sophomore from Huntsville, Alabama. Hitting 306 on the year and second on the Diamond Dogs and runs batted in with 10. First hit for the Bulldogs, a one-out single for Foscue.
Nice line drive there going with the pitch and gives Mississippi State a guy on base to see what they do here.
Craig Lamone is the new head coach of Mississippi State after 4 successful seasons at Indiana, 3 of those seasons. Hoosiers making it to the NCAA regionals. He likes to be aggressive. This Mississippi State team, 12 stolen bases and 15 attempts coming in, although Foscue has not attempted a stolen base so far this year.
He does have a healthy lead at first.
Here's Dustin Skelton, the Bulldog catcher. Appeal to first and strike call from our first base umpire, John Wolf.
First pitch breaking ball with a guy on first base. I believe that's the first time he's gone to an off-speed pitch to start a hitter off. And talking to the Mississippi State coaching staff last night, they usually don't like bunting until you get later in the game. They're going to let their guy swing the bat.
Hearn runs out of room.
Close, just about 2 feet away from maybe making an attempt at that in the dugout. Here we see, he sees it, he's there, he feels the railing, but just runs out of room.
Skelton Jr. from Olive Branch, Mississippi, an 0-2 count to him.
Tell you what, you have to have powerful legs if you're Skelton. The way that he squats in his batting stance, this is a little bit like Ricky Henderson, if you can remember him, but just how low he's getting before the pitch is made.
Not Jeff Bagwell-esque, but, right. But more Ricky Henderson-esque, the stance. Called strike 3 to Skelton, second K for Wisniewski.
Here you see the breaking ball. It really didn't do exactly what he wanted to, but it still got good enough break and was able to full Skelton.
You pitched, of course, even as high as the major league level. Is the cold something that pitchers can get used to right away? Because temperatures are going to be in the 40s all day long here.
Yeah, as soon as your adrenaline starts going, you get you try to get break a sweat in your bullpen as you're warming up. And once you do that and you get into the action, you usually feel pretty good. It's sometimes I found it detrimental when I was playing one time in Ottawa, super cold in AAA. It was in the 20s, and I put on 2 pair of sleeves. And I felt like after a couple innings, it was restricting me. I had actually too much gear on to stay cold and notice, I need all that if I'm sitting in the dugout watching the game, but if you're pitching, you don't need all that.
Inside to Jordan, and our first 2-0 count to any hitter so far today.
I must have been really distracting Wisniewski while I was talking while he was pitching because he's been just pounding the strike zone, and here we have a favorable count. We'll see if Mississippi State wants to do anything on the bases here.
A little colder in the dugout than it is out in the field.
Yes.
2-0.
Comes with a good fastball inside, upper part of the strike zone. Gets back into the count. This is a pretty good pitch to run on here with 2 outs if you want to try to get a guy in scoring position.
Now a 3-1 count to Jordan. Freshman All-American by D1Baseball.com last season when he hit 321. So far, Jordan this year at 229, but with 4 doubles.
Good pitch, just a little bit low there.
Now the count is full.
Well, now I bet the runner will be running on this one as we have 3-2, 2 out. So runner will be on the move. So a ball in the gap can get you a run here.
Mentioned, of course, cold. Really no wind to speak of. Supposed to get windier tomorrow and especially into Sunday. And a chance of rain tomorrow, which is why both games have been moved up to noon and 4 o'clock first pitches. The payoff with two outs. Got him. Third strikeout for Wisniewski, and that'll do it in the bottom half of the second. Pitcher's duel as we expected in Frisco. Scoreless, Sam Houston State and Mississippi State. Ethan Small last season, 122 strikeouts. He is well ahead of that pace already, and this just his third start of the young season with 27 strikeouts. And it's looked good so far. He was chosen in the 26th round of the 2018 first-year player draft by the Arizona Diamondbacks, but now the ace of this Mississippi State staff. And that's saying something because another hurdler for Mississippi State is JT Ginn, who was picked in the first round by the Los Angeles Dodgers last season. Said no, said it was his lifelong dream to put on the Mississippi State uniform, and that is an awfully good 1-2 punch for Chris Lemonis and his Mississippi State Bulldogs.
Yeah, that's rare in today's game that you can get a guy that was drafted in the first round or first few rounds, and then they decide to come to college. So I'm sure Mississippi State was really excited about that. I've talked to coaches before about that, and sometimes they say, yeah, we give scholarships to guys that we know are first round picks out of high school, but we almost know that we're going to have to reuse that pretty quickly.
Eric Bonnert looking for his first hit of the year. He's 0 for 5. Now a 2-1 count.
Well, he's in a favorable count here, and this is kind of so far one of the guys, Eric Bonnert, who's been patient at the plate, and those pitches are close, but he's waiting for his pitch, making Ethan Small work.
Takes a strike after showing bunt 2-2.
Yeah, and you wouldn't show bunt just to show it on 2-1 because now you're in a 2-2 count. So he was looking to bunt for a base hit as the third baseman was playing back on that but didn't like where the pitch was to try to bunt it. So now he has to protect the plate with two strikes, choking up on the bat.
Over the glove of Jordan Westberg and a base hit the first of the season for Bonnert.
Nice line drive, nice two-strike approach as you see Bonnert, who really changed his approach from earlier in the count. He brings the hands back, almost kind of slap hitting right there, and hits a line drive right over Westberg's head, and looked like he might have mistimed his jump just barely at shortstop.
Now, I thought when the ball left the bat that Westberg was going to snag it, but it kept lifting, and as you said, maybe a little mistime on the jump. Allows Bonnert to reach base to lead off the third.
It's so tough when the ball's hit like that. It's a line drive, and you're trying to say, well, was that ball hit really good? And I think that ball was hit good but not great, and that's why he might have jumped a little bit early.
Kyle Moose, the Bearcat catcher, takes the first pitch for a ball. He's from Castroville, Texas, and also looking for his first hit of the season, unless he's successful in moving Bonnert to second. He's 0-3 on the year coming in with a couple of walks.
And right here, if he is sacrifice bunting, you want to bunt towards first base.
Showing bunt before the pitch.
Third baseman is in tight.
And that's foul.
And the reason you want to do that is the third baseman can obviously cheat. He's not holding anybody on. He's obviously not worried about somebody running to third base. The first baseman has to hold his ground, especially with a lefty pitcher. He doesn't know when he lifts his leg if he's still going to come to first base. So the first baseman can't really gain any ground. He's not going to field the bunt. It's really the pitcher's responsibility, for the most part, to field a bunt towards first base in this situation. Squaring around really early. Can always pull it back if you feel a third baseman comes in too hard on you.
1-1. Beautifully placed. Skelton misplays the ball and everyone's safe.
Skelton looked like he pulled his head up right as he was going down to pick up the baseball. He pulled his head up to see if he had a play at second base. Here's the replay on it. It is a beautiful bunt. Get the sacrifice done. You see Skelton, he picked up his head right there to see if he had a chance to throw it to second. And usually you'll still be able to if you don't look that ball all the way in, pick it up. But it's one of those things when you go over just the fundamentals of the game. Make sure if you're going to pick a ball up barehanded that you really push that ball down into the ground to pull it up. And you watch yourself do that and don't look up at the runners.
So does Diego Davila try to move both runners over? Already showing bunt. Here's the pitch from Small. Small to third. And that's in time to get Bonnard.
Good job getting off the mound there by Ethan Small and recognizing that he should have a play at third base. And by Foscue holding his position at third, had a person to throw to. The first base charging in hard. Bunt just a little bit hard. You can either deaden it there or you have to bunt it hard where the third baseman has to leave his position to field the ball. So if you get the third baseman to leave his position, you've done your job and the guy can get to third.
Now top of the order, and Matt Odom, who reached on a bunt single to begin this game but was caught trying to steal third to end the threat. And so we've seen already a number of bunt attempts by this Bearcat team, but I don't think any surprise with Ethan Small on the mound how Matt Deggs is feeling, you know, I just need to get any run I can, especially with the way Wesneski has been pitching, not just today, but all year long.
Yeah, exactly. And when you're a pitcher on the mound in this situation, you have to gain confidence that they don't feel great about hitting you when they're trying to sacrifice and bunt for hits a lot.
Time called.
Now, that being said, you have to field your position. So far, two of the bunts that Sam Houston State has reached on, they've been hits, but you could call them errors in the situations just because Small got to the ball that he got to, Skelton got to the ball that he got to. They just weren't able to pick it up clean and then make a throw.
Strike call. So the inning started with an Eric Bonnard single and then the sacrifice, but E2 allowing Moose to reach base. He's now on at second and Davila at first after the fielder's choice on his sacrifice attempt to try to move both Moose and Bonnard over.
You know, I have noticed from Sam Houston State, a lot of their hitters do like choking up on the bat. The good pitch there, just barely missed inside. It's just sometimes when they get to two strikes, Sam Houston State as a team looks like that is their philosophy. We're going to choke up on the bat. We're going to try to slap the ball hard for line drives and put pressure on the defense to make a play. Here it's a 2-1 count, so you don't see as much of a choke up here from the hitter.
Now 2-2. It's tougher to hit the long ball here than at Sam Houston State's home in Huntsville, Don Sanders Stadium. And it's not just because of the cold weather. 364 to the alleys and 409 to straightaway center. 335 to left and right center field here.
I've called quite a few games for the Frisco Rough Riders, the AA team for the Texas Rangers that plays here. And the ball carries better to left than right field. And I have never seen, and I'm sure it's happened, I don't call all the games, a ball go out to dead center field in a game.
Bulldog fans wanted the strike. Instead, the count is full.
I thought that was a good call. It was a very, really good pitch, but I thought it was just off the inner half of the plate. It's a good pitch, and now, you know, you make another one. As you see the catcher set up inside, and that ball still, it's on that kneecap, and you know that he went to set up inside, even though it's inside the shoulders. That ball was just barely inside. So far, a great strike zone, I think, from the umpire behind the plate.
Got him. Big strikeout for the second out of the top of the third.
Good job by Small here. He attacks the strike zone. You see he wanted to go inside again. He missed his spot and got it over the middle, but he has good enough stuff and movement that he's still able to get the strikeout.
Third strikeout of the day for Small, and couldn't come at a better time. He's now up to 27 strikeouts and zero walks on the season. And here's McKnight.
That was always a pitch that I, as a lefty pitcher, that sometimes I like going to the slide step changeup, where it looks like your body's going quick to home plate, and then you don't throw it quick to home plate, and can really mess up the timing of the hitter.
Spin back and no throw to try to pick off Moose.
Good decision. Not a very big lead there. You want to try to keep them close because obviously a base hit, they're probably going to try to score. Right fielder is pretty shallow, so a hard hit ball to right field is going to be tough to score on.
That hits McKnight. I had to wait for a second because he pulled the bat back, and I was waiting for our home plate umpire, Doug Williams, to give us the official ruling because I thought maybe this would hit a piece of the bat as well. Instead, a hit by pitch, and the bases are loaded.
Yeah, it's tough to tell right there if it got possibly the knob of the bat or somewhere around the wrist area, but you see the reaction of the wince there. And so now we have bases loaded, two outs. A big situation here for Mississippi State and Ethan Small.
And so here's Colton Cowser. Arnie mentioned how his head coach, Matt Deggs, raves about this young man, just a freshman. He says people just need to sit back and enjoy watching him. Calls him a natural-born hitter. And at the plate with the bases loaded and two outs here in the third. First pitch strike.
Breaking ball a little bit high, but gets the top part of the strike zone. As Mississippi State's playing pretty straight up here on Cowser in the outfield.
He's the top 2021 draft prospect in the Southland Conference, according to D1 Baseball. To center. Mangum under it. And Small gets out of the jam. Little bit of everything in that inning, except a run, as the Bearcats leave the bases loaded.
Cowser hits the ball well here. He gets a fastball out over the plate, but hit it right to the center fielder.
Mississippi State, Sam Houston State, our first game of the weekend in Frisco.
I'm Joe Flacco, quarterback for the Baltimore Ravens. I'm also a proud supporter of the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. My niece Chelsea was born with cystic fibrosis. CF is a rare disease that shortens lives. The CF Foundation is making great progress towards a cure, but we're not in the end zone yet. We still lose young people to CF every day. I want Chelsea and all people with CF to live long and full lives. Join a team that saves lives. Support the search for a cure today.
The Frisco Classic is presented by Baylor Scott & White Sports Performance Center at the Star. Move, perform, recover. Learn more at spcatthestar.com. Our biggest threat of the afternoon. Bearcats, though, come up empty as they leave the bases loaded in the top half of the third. Still scoreless with the Bearcats out hitting Mississippi State 2-1. And the bottom half of the third beginning for Mississippi State with their 8, 9, and 1 hitters. Hayden Jones, Gunnar Halter, And then one of their stars, Jake Mangum, due up third here in the third.
And so far, Wesneski has only given up one hit, three strikeouts, and 28 pitches through two innings. So great start for him in this game so far.
Justin Foscue, the only man to reach base for the Bulldogs, on a one-out single in the second. Big cut by Jones. He's the Bulldog-designated hitter today. Freshman from Huntertown, Indiana.
Quite a few lefties in Mississippi State's lineup, and that ball looks like it's a strike on the outer half of the plate, and then it just runs just off the plate, just like that one, and you get a nice, easy comebacker. That's an error.
That's going to be an error on the pitcher, perhaps, and Hunter Hearn feels like he should have fielded that ball, but that was a throw that was a bit short to the Bearcat first baseman. Regardless of who the error is on, Mississippi State is the leadoff runner aboard.
Well, as you can tell right here, he guides the ball. He's been throwing the ball 90 miles an hour to home and then really lobs the ball over there and short arms it. And you can see he's upset with himself. And I would give the error to the pitcher there, and it is given to the pitcher as it's an E1. But that is also one that you'd love for your first baseman to pick you up. But when you throw it that soft to a first baseman, it's easier to pick up a ball when it's 85 to 90 miles an hour. When it's thrown about 65 miles an hour, it's tough for it to stick in the glove.
Gunnar Halter pulls back and the pitch a ball to the Mississippi State second baseman. Halter Jr. from Overland Park, Kansas.
You can see here Mississippi State taking some signs here. There was a square around for a sacrifice, but I also think the weather at times when it is in the low 40s like it is today in Frisco, that you sometimes have to play a little bit more small ball because the ball's not going to carry. As we saw, Kowser hit a ball well to center field, but it didn't go very, very good.
That bunt foul. Now, Gunner's the son of Shane Halter, played in the majors for eight seasons, 45 career homers. Best year in 2001 with the Tigers, hit .284, 12 home runs.
Yeah.
You ever get the chance to face Shane?
You'd have to check on, like, baseballreference.com.
Wait, you don't remember everyone you faced?
I don't remember everyone I faced. In 2001, I did not play against Detroit in the major leagues, but right. I made a played against them in Toledo. I played in Cleveland. That was my rookie year there. And then played most of the season in Buffalo for the AAA Cleveland Indians back then, and Toledo was AAA for Detroit.
So Bull Durham's wrong? I mean, Crash Davis, I thought, remembered everybody that
he might have.
So.
He might have been the LeBron of Sean McVay.
Bunt nicely plays. Halter does the job.
That's a great job there getting the bunt down and getting a runner into scoring position for Mississippi State. Yeah, people ask me that. I can kind of remember if I faced guys like Ichiro or Pudge Rodriguez or Ken Griffey Jr., but it's tough to remember everybody.
With all due respect to Shane Halter, he just had 45 career homers, but,
Don't worry. He won't remember if he did face me unless he hit a homer off of me. He ain't remembering me.
So you only remember the homers. That's the rule.
Yeah.
All right, top of the order now in Mangum. He has a chance, this young man, to be the all-time hits leader, not just in Mississippi State history, but SEC history.
Wow.
.288 coming into today. Eddie Furness of LSU with .352 back from 1995 to 1998. The Mississippi State record held by Jeffrey Ray, third most in SEC history. Ray with .335 from 2004 through 2007. And Chris Lamona simply says that this young man, Jake Mangum, is our leader. Just foul, 1-1.
That could have been trouble because Sam Houston State is playing Mangum to hit the ball the other way. So if that ball could have got down the line, the right fielder there was playing pretty far off the line, Clayton Harp. Now, LSU, you mentioned that team. Did LSU on that team have like a walk-off homer in the College World Series to win it? You're naming 95 through 98. Is that what you said there?
Skip, and that's really when the dominance of the Skip Bertman team started at LSU, and Eddie Furness, one of their best. Of course, Mississippi State making it to Omaha last season, as well as Texas Tech, who we'll see tonight against Nebraska.
I graduated high school in 1996, and I remember Mississippi State being one of those schools that you really hoped to get recruited by because they were a powerhouse in the 90s too. And one of my favorite players was Will Clark as a kid, and I knew that Will Clark had gone to Mississippi State.
Well, the Bulldogs, Starkville's always been a great place to host a baseball game. And even better now with Duty Noble Stadium being renovated. They call it the new dude. Can fit 15,000 into the place. Good job by Odom to backtrack and make that catch. Tagging the third is Jones, but there's now two away.
Two balls hit well to center field today, but the ball's just not going to carry that great to center field here, and especially when it's cold early in the year. You should be able to, if you have a good center fielder, track a lot of those balls in the air. If you're a pitcher, you're trying to really keep the ball in this park, especially to the center part of the field where your outfielder, especially your center fielder, can run them down.
There's a second leader on this Bulldog team. Chris Lamona says it's this young man in Jordan Westberg. Looking to get Jones home with two outs. Mentioned that Mississippi State made it to the College World Series last season. And Westberg in Omaha lore, he said a Mississippi State single game College World Series standard, seven runs batted in against North Carolina. It's back on June 19th. Hit the only grand slam in all of the College World Series last year. And again, just as a freshman.
What's interesting here for Westberg is we haven't seen too many shifts on the infield so far, but here we have the second baseman playing straight up the middle and the shortstop really playing the left side of the hole here. So there is room to work on the right side of the infield for a ground ball to get through.
Tap foul.
But with Wesneski, he's really throwing a good sinker ball at that three-quarters arm. That ball's really sinking into the right-hander's hands and away from the left-hander, and he's really been able to command that fastball on the arm side of the plate. We'll see here after throwing a sinker hard in if he goes to that breaking ball, which he's got some strikeouts on today.
Got him.
Went with the sinker in again. Good pitch.
So Jones reaches on the air by Wesneski, but is stranded at third, and both pitchers escaping jams in inning number three. Still scoreless in Frisco.
And while you're on your phone, hop a follow on our Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter feeds. Be sure to use the hashtag #BestOutsideOfOmaha all weekend long and sharing those great photos. And let's turn our attention up to the video board for our first Baylor Scott & White trivia question of the weekend. Let's get it started by asking you what conference these Sam Houston State Bearcats are a part of. Southland, SEC, the Big 12, or the Sun Belt? Yell it out. What do you think? We're looking for A, the Southland Conference. Mission of the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation is to cure cystic fibrosis and provide all people with the disease the opportunity to lead full, productive lives by funding research and drug development.
David Salzman, Mike Bassick with you here at the 2019 Frisco College Baseball Classic. Temperature at 42 degrees, so not your typical baseball weather, obviously, but both Ethan Small and Hayden Wesneski have been as advertised, the aces of these two fine staffs. A scoreless game as we start the top of the fourth.
Well, the good thing about 42 degrees right now is the wind's not blowing. If it was 42 and you had about a 15-mile-an-hour wind, it would be really cold. But it's 42 with very little wind.
Hearn struck out his first time up. Now the count 1-1. Now, you said you've pitched when it's been in the 20s during your minor league career up in Ottawa?
Yeah, if you have to play in the International League where it's a lot of Buffalo and Syracuse, Rochester, I think Ottawa's not in the league anymore, but if you have to play up there in April, Yeah, you'll get snow flurries. You can get colded out. I remember in Indianapolis one time, I wasn't playing for Indy but against them, and it was 19 degrees. And they're like, oh, we're not playing tonight. And we're like, thank you. Because you get to the point where it's just – it's miserable, you know, kind of in that northeastern area in April.
Check swing, no swing, says John Wolf over at first. So it's going to be cold all weekend, but because of the chance of rain late Saturday, if you haven't heard, both games tomorrow have been moved up a couple of hours. Sam Houston, Nebraska at noon tomorrow. Texas Tech and Mississippi State, 4 o'clock tomorrow here in Frisco.
You know, it's interesting with Ethan Small is now Hunter Hearn has worked the count to a full count. He's really using the top part of the strike zone and even above that to really get some swings and misses. And that's really, I would say, over the last five or so years, somewhat new in baseball. And it's just because of the way hitters are trying to launch the ball now that pitching in the upper part of the zone is better. And there's a great changeup for strike three.
We were close again to Ethan Small allowing his first walk of the season, but he gets earned for the second time, and that's 5 Ks now for Small.
When you're a scout here and you're watching Ethan Small and you're able to throw off-speed pitches, secondary pitches on 3-2 counts, or if you're behind in the count, you know you have a pitcher and not a thrower on the mound, and Ethan Small knows how to work the strike zone.
Clayton Hart struck out his first time up as well. Three homers last weekend in a series sweep of a very good Louisiana Ragin' Cajun squad. He was 8 for 13, 9 runs batted in over that weekend. Now 2-0.
Trying to work soft and on the outer part of the plate there. Just missing. 2-0. You wanted to see a walk, right, Dave? I mean, you've been begging for one. Here's a 2-0 count.
2-1 now. Ethan. No. I don't mind not seeing the walk. I enjoy the intrigue.
Yeah. Well, Ethan Small was not panicked by a 2-0 count as he throws a great fastball down in the zone and gets right back into the count.
Jordan Cannon on deck. And from 2-0 now 2-2.
There's that upper part of the zone where at times, 10, 15 years ago, you might not want to throw in that area, but the more guys aren't trying to hit line drives, at least at a professional level, and I know that's starting to trickle down, that you're trying to get launch angles and stuff, that you can pitch in that zone a lot more.
Lifted to right. McNamee there for the second out.
And I'm sure now I've gone to batting cages around this Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex where we're in Frisco as we see pitch here, fastball over the heart of the plate, good swing, but you know, on a cold day the ball's probably not going to carry as much. As you can go to these batting cages now, Dave, and you can get your swing and your bat speed and the launch angle and the revolutions that you're hitting, you know, the ball, and so if you're getting that done at 10, 12, 15 years old, I'm sure these college guys are trying to create the perfect launch angle and all that stuff too.
Here's Jordan Cannon, first pitch fouled. And you mentioned how, you know, last inning we saw a couple of shifts. I've recognized that on the college level, how we're seeing more and more shifts in college baseball. Obviously, we see it, you know, multiple times every game on the major league level.
Yeah, and you know, when you get to probably SEC baseball or you get to Southland Conference baseball, you might see more because you have a idea of what those guys do because you're going to face them in three-game series. And it's probably tougher when you're playing early on in the season and you don't know – the Mississippi State team well if you're Sam Houston State because you're only going to play them one time all year and probably not play them next year. I don't know everybody's schedule next year, but you're not going to worry too much about getting great scouting reports. But when it comes to conference play, I'm sure the coaches have a much better idea of the lineups they're going against.
1-2 to Cannon with two outs. Base hit. Ripped to left off the bat of Cannon, and he's on with a two-out single. Third hit for Sam Houston State, all singles.
Well, Ethan Small gets aggressive with a fastball. He gets into that upper part of the zone, but for Cannon there, he has a really solid level swing and gets a line drive just past Justin Foscue at third base.
So Eric Bonnert singled to begin the third. In the third inning, Bearcats had their chances. A single, hitter reaching base on an error off a sacrifice attempt, and also a hit batter. Yet all were left on. This won't leave the infield. Tanner Allen there, and that'll do it. Bearcats have left four the last two innings, but we remain scoreless. Jeff Fish, the Vice President of Athlete Healthcare for Baylor Scott & White Performance Center at the Star, will join us when we return.
I'm Joe Flacco, quarterback for the Baltimore Ravens. I'm also a proud supporter of the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation. My niece Chelsea was born with cystic fibrosis. CF is a rare disease that shortens lives. The CF Foundation is making great progress towards a cure, but we're not in the end zone yet. We still lose young people to CF every day. I want Chelsea and all people with CF to live long and full lives. Join a team that saves lives. Support the search for a cure today.
Sam Houston State, Mississippi State, first game of the 2019 Frisco College Baseball Classic. We're scoreless. Meet of the order for Mississippi State due up, Tanner Allen, Elijah McNamee, and Justin Foscue. David Salzman, Mike Bassick with you, and a special guest. So I mentioned going into last break, it would be Jeff Fish, the Vice President of Athlete Healthcare. We are told, though, Jeff is ill today. So, of course, he deserves the day off as Allen reaches on a first-pitch single to begin the fourth. But happy that he's joining us as he did last year here in Frisco. Mike Oviedo, the Director of Performance Healthcare for Baylor Scott & White Performance Center at the Star. Thanks so much for joining us. You know, first off, you know, especially for those who may not be familiar with what your wonderful facility is and does, what does the Baylor Scott & White Performance Center at the Star do for so many people?
It's a complete and total healthcare model for the athlete. So not only do we do performance training, but we also have movement therapy, recovery options, and recovery is a big thing nowadays. So cryo, plunge pools, compression boots, you name it. We take care of the athlete from head to toe.
Elijah McNamee takes a first pitch ball. You know, Mike Bassick and I were just talking about how the game of baseball is developing, be it analytics or what have you. But when it comes to helping athletes recover, stay healthy and strong, how has that evolved even over just the last couple of years at your facility?
Oh, it's huge. I mean, every athlete now is looking at not just getting bigger, faster, stronger, but more importantly, also reducing the risk of injury.
That hit over the glove of Bonnert, and racing around third is Tanner Allen. We have our first run of the game, an RBI double by McNamee.
Mississippi State has been attacking early in the count, and here in the fourth inning, it is paying off as you get a leadoff single and now a double with an RBI. And here we see a ball hit great, and great effort here by Bonnert. Just misses it. I think it might have nicked his glove there, and the relay really had no chances. Allen scores easily.
So the middle of the order doing the job. McNamee, his 10th run batted in, and Tanner Allen with the first run in Frisco here in 2019. Mike Oviedo is the Director of Performance Healthcare, Baylor Scott & White Performance Center at the Star. Sorry to cut you off with the big play, but tell us again how your industry has evolved to help athletes from all around the state, all around the country who come to Baylor Scott & White Performance Center.
Yeah, so again, typically the emphasis has always been on making the athlete bigger, faster, and stronger, but a lot of research has been coming out on recovery, which is really helping the athletes stay healthy.
Well, you are good luck for Mississippi State. McNamee scores off the Foscue single, and what was a scoreless game is now 2-0, three straight hits for the Bulldogs.
I believe it's four pitches, three hits in this inning. I mean, Mississippi State has not gone away from we are going to swing early in the count right here for Wisniewski. That's just unlucky. He gets a bouncing ball, but it bounces over the third base head. And for Mississippi State, putting the ball in play and now getting a two-run lead here in the fourth inning.
We'll see Jay Sirianni, the pitching coach for Sam Houston State, talk to his young hurler in Wisniewski. So, you know, once again, Baylor Scott & White Performance Center at the Star. You are the major sponsor of this tournament. Why get involved with the Frisco College Baseball Classic, as you've done now for 3 years?
Yes, because it's so important to take care of these athletes, especially the ones that want to end up going into the professionals. I mean, they have to stay healthy. It's one thing to be big, fast, strong. But if they are not available to play, then they're not the best athlete out there. So, like I said, you could be big, fast, strong, quick, powerful. You can hit home runs, but if you're not healthy, you're not going to help the team out.
For someone watching who may be a young athlete or a parent of one, who's the youngest who you help?
I've helped children as young as 11 years of age.
Mm-hmm. And then the oldest, what's the range of age that you help?
So I've helped athletes from the age of 11 up to the age of 80 years of age.
Really? How can one help someone who is 80 continue to be bigger, faster, stronger, even at that age?
Oh, you'd be surprised. He probably would say that he has been bigger, faster. But for him, for the 80-year-old, it's really all about increasing his balance, okay, and his core strength, keeping him healthy so he can keep skiing on the slopes and racing.
Here's Dustin Skelton. Snap throw to first, but not in time. It's Foskew on first after he knocked in Elijah McNamee with the inning second run. McNamee's double scoring Tanner Allen and the two on the board for Mississippi State here in the bottom half of the fourth inning.
Really interesting that Skelton squared around there to possibly sacrifice bunt just because Mississippi State's off to such a great start here in the fourth inning and putting the ball in play and finding holes.
That bunt just goes foul.
And right there, more trying to bunt for a hit. Obviously, if you're bunting the ball that hard to first base, you're trying to get on base that way.
How many physicians work at Baylor Scott & White Performance Health Center?
We have quite a few. We have a full ninth floor is full of general medicine doctors, internal medicine. Eighth floor is orthopedics from spine, ankle, foot, shoulder, knee. Everybody has a specialization. The fourth floor is our surgical center for athletes and anybody else who wants to come in there. Urgent care, imaging, we have it all.
How often do professional athletes go through your doors?
Quite a bit. We have a couple of NFL guys in right now. I've had, over the summertime before the NBA season picked up, we had one of the players from the Dallas Mavericks come in.
Clayton Hart makes the catch, and Skelton's the first out.
Yeah, so we get athletes. It's a revolving door depending upon when their season's over or when it starts.
Mike Oviedo, the Director of Performance Healthcare at Baylor Scott & White Performance Center at the Star. How many years now has Baylor Scott & White Performance Health Center been around? Because it seems new, but I think it's been around probably longer than I'm thinking.
Yes, we had a temporary facility over here by the Dr. Pepper Arena for the first year and a half, and then we got into the building last year in March. We're fully up and running now with everything, so it's just been picking up since then. We got a great team over there, great staff, great professionals. Our strength coaches are from the professional ranks, like lots of years of experience.
Roddy Jordan struck out his first time up. A runner on first is Foskew with one away here in the fourth. Lifted to right, and Harp once again is there. And now two away. What's the best way for those interested to get more information about Baylor Scott & White Performance Health Center?
They can check out our website. They can give us a phone call. We have free athlete evaluations that we do. And we also have the full test for athletes' movement efficiency to see whether or not their risk of injury is high or moderate or low. So it's just a matter of going on the website, spc@thestar.com, or even give us a call. I believe on the back of the scorecards, all information is right there for him.
That's spc@thestar.com. Here's Hayden Jones, designated hitter and the sixth man to bat this inning.
Well, this inning I've noticed, too, for the first time, Mississippi State's been able to elevate the ball in the air. Even though there's been two outs here in this inning and Wisniewski's kind of finding his rhythm a little bit, they're fly ball outs. And early on in the game, they were strikeouts and ground outs. So Mississippi State's able to get that ball in the air and get a couple runs here.
Mike, even in just the few years that the facility has been open, where have you seen the most, you know, evolution and progress towards helping young athletes?
A lot of it's been in the training room. So we get a lot of athletes coming in for the full movement efficiency test, range of motion test, just because they want to make sure that before their season starts that they're ready to go, they're not hurting, they're moving well. And then during the season, they come in, get tuned up before a game, make sure that everything's working properly. The strength and conditioning piece has really been coming along great. We have a great room, great staff, and they've been doing really good with a lot of the high schools we have around here in Frisco.
Are you able to get to talk to quite a few of the strength conditioning coaches, trainers that work with high school athletes to try to give them a better idea on how to avoid seeing you so much?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, our strength coaches are great, that they go out to the schools on a regular basis almost every day, and they work with the coaches, they work with the players to make sure that they're lifting properly, they got the proper technique, everybody's doing what they should be doing to get better.
3-1 count to Jones. And now the count is full.
I was reading a story about Mike Miner, who pitches for the Texas Rangers, Mike, and he was talking about how he was doing a lot of football weightlifting because he just wanted to get bigger and stronger, but not really work on his baseball muscles. So can you talk about how different it is as a football athlete compared to a baseball athlete?
Oh, yeah, it's definitely good for an athlete to cross-train into different sports and do different things, because the athlete who stays in the same sport for too long ends up getting hurt.
Bonner, good running grab to prevent another run from scoring. Mike Oviedo, Director of Performance Healthcare at Baylor Scott & White Performance Center at the Star. Thanks for all you do and for your support of this great event.
Appreciate
good to see you
so
again.
Much.
And Mississippi State was really happy you came for that inning.
I hope I don't walk through Sam Houston's fan base.
Come back for the bottom of the fifth. Bulldog fans won. 2-0, Mississippi State. David Salzman, Mike Bassick with you. 2-0, the Mississippi State lead. And so the Sam Houston State Bearcats with work to do against Ethan Small, who's allowed 3 hits through 4 innings of work. And for the first time, Mike, on the mound with an edge.
Yeah, he gets the 2-0 lead. Let's see how you pitch with the lead and try to get also that first W of the year for Ethan Small. He's had a great season so far, but hasn't been able to get a win on his record. And he's 53 pitches into this game, so he should be able to go at least a few more innings and try to keep Sam Houston State from scoring.
0-2 count to Moose, the Bearcat catcher, to lead things off. Yeah, Small's just happy to see his team score. He was dominant in an appearance against Southern Miss 1 week ago, but his team didn't get a run across. It was a 1-0 loss in 10 innings. Small was not part of that decision.
Almost got a strikeout there, but just missed. Make it a 1-2 count. As we talked about Ethan Small earlier in the game, he has multiple different motions. He can quick pitch you, he can hesitate, and then he has his normal rhythm of a motion in the windup.
Got him. 5 strikeouts now for Small, 29 on the season. He actually opened the campaign with 11 strikeouts against Youngstown State. That was a career high before his 13 strikeout performance against Southern Miss 1 week ago.
Yeah, and we don't have a radar gun here. The Frisco Rough Riders usually do, but it's not on today. Small usually throws the ball, as we were told last night, 88 to 94. The hitters are reacting like it's in the mid-90s. The ball's just getting on top of guys quickly. And then Small's able to then throw secondary pitches, his changeup, a little bit more than his breaking ball, but both pitches he's been able to throw for strikes to keep Sam Houston State off balance today.
Diego Davila, who's 0 for 1 now at the plate.
And there's a good changeup there. And once he does that, then you can't cheat as much to try to catch up to the early, you know, the low 90s fastball. And let's see if Sam Houston State kind of chokes up on the bat here. A little bit of a choke up. You can see Sam Houston State goes to that two-strike approach and off-speed pitch for the K. It's always interesting, too, Dave, early on in the year, you're only 7 to 10 games into a season, on how much do you want Ethan Small to pitch? It is 42 degrees. This is a guy that you really want to pitch in big-time conference games and win your conference championship. He's at 60 pitches right now through 4 2/3. And he looks like he's dominating and can go all 9 innings. It's just a matter of how much do you want to push a guy early in the year in a non-conference game.
He's on pace to get over 100 strikeouts again. And if he can get to 100, he'll be just the sixth Bulldog to ever have multiple 100-plus strikeout seasons in program history. A quick 1-2-3 frame for Ethan Small in the top half of the fifth. Bulldogs up 2-0 halfway through. Texas Tech, Nebraska, our nightcap set to start at 7 o'clock. And right now, Mississippi State looking to go to 9-1 on the Young campaign, a 2-0 lead over the team picked to win the Southland Conference in Sam Houston State. They won the Southland last season at 24-6, but were just left out of the NCAA tournament, losing 2 of 3 in the Southland Conference tournament. Here's Gunnar Halter, who's 0 for 1, a first pitch ball. Besides getting into trouble with those three straight hits to begin the fourth, what have you liked about Wesneski so far?
Well, he's attacked the strike zone. He's getting ahead quite a bit in the count here. We have a 1-1 count here. The one thing that you noticed in that last inning is the ball started getting in the air off the bat. And you can tell from Wesneski the way he throws the ball, he wants that sinker and slider to work where he's getting strikeouts and ground balls. And Mississippi State was able to elevate him a little bit. You see there a great pitch by Wesneski, foul ball, but jams a guy, ball hit softly on the ground. When he's successful, the ball's staying on the ground. If you can get him to get that fastball up in the zone, then you have a chance to get the ball in the air and maybe do some damage. It's a little bit different from Ethan Small. Ethan Small has pitched a lot in the upper part of the strike zone today, where Wesneski has been successful in the lower part of the strike zone.
Halter's worth the count full. Mangum and Westberg to follow. One SEC team already with a victory today. Arkansas defeated Stony Brook 3-1.
Big full count pitch here. Don't want to lead off walk.
And the count remains full.
Good job by Halter to foul it off.
The toughest division in college baseball is the SEC West. Mississippi State was picked sixth. And this is a team that went to Omaha last season, brought a lot of their players back, including Ethan Small, who's been great so far today, and yet picked sixth out of the seven teams in the West. Good job ranging to his right. McKnight and on the first in time.
Yeah, made that look easy. That was a tough play there as the balls popped up right over the pitcher's head and was able to get up the middle. And Riley McKnight made this look really smooth here. No panic there. He knew that he could throw the ball off balance and throw the ball accurately. So what you're telling me, Dave, is if you're in the SEC, you want to be in the West for football. But you want to be in the East for baseball.
I don't know. It seems like – I guess it depends on the year for football, right? Yeah. The East has tailed off a bit. Of course, the West, you got to face Alabama every year.
Yeah, the West is definitely. Sorry, but, Auburn, LSU.
Well, but in baseball, you got the East. You have Vanderbilt, who DABaseball.com is ranked number one. That's a nice backhanded stop by Davila. But still reaching safely will be Mangum, and he's on with one out. You know, Florida.
Yeah.
You know, a few years off a College World Series title.
They're in the East. They usually always have great prospects on their team. You can see here on this great play by Davila to get to the ball, but it just goes to show in the major leagues how strong some of those shortstops' arms are. You know, the Derek Jeter throw and other guys can do it now in the major leagues too. I played with Omar Vizquel, and he could get into that hole, do that jump throw, and from 120 feet away, still get enough on the ball to make a play closer to get a guy out.
So here's Westberg, who struck out both times up. If you're just joining us, Mississippi State got their two runs in the fourth on three consecutive hits to begin the frame. Tanner Allen, who's on deck, got the inning started with a single. Elijah McNamee drove him in with a double, and then McNamee scored off a single by Justin Foscue. 5-3, the hits in favor of Mississippi State.
And that play up the middle by Riley McKnight even looms larger after a base hit. Mm-hmm. That would have been that ball wouldn't even fielded if there would have been a runner on first, because you would have been in double play depth. But with just a runner on first and one out is a big difference than first and second and nobody out here.
This one may be trouble. McKnight on the run and a sliding grab by Riley McKnight. His second spectacular defensive play of the inning.
He's my Gold Glove Award winner in this game so far. Wow. Going up the middle on a ground ball off balance. And here you called it. It was trouble. And it looked like it was going to fall foul. But McKnight is able to run over, slide, and catch the ball, and that is a really, really tough play. The only play that was going to be made was by the second baseman. Right fielder was too far away, and Hunter Hearn, the first baseman, wasn't going to be able to, holding on the runner, get back there in time.
So he saved the base hit off the bat of Halter by making a great play to his right and then ranging all the way into foul ground for that sliding grab of Westberg's foul ball. Here's Allen, 1-for-2 with a single and a run scored. Texas Tech, Nebraska, our nightcap, set to begin at 7. Now, if you're planning on coming out to the ballpark tomorrow, make note of the new start times. Mississippi State will take on Texas Tech, but that's at 4 instead of 6. Sam Houston, Nebraska will begin at noon. The count.
Wisniewski right here. He's trying to slide step and be a little bit quicker to home plate. And as you get a little bit more fatigued, you got to really get that ball out of your glove earlier. If you don't, you've noticed the last two pitches have been high and out of the strike zone. So if you're going to go to a quicker motion with your lower half, the ball has to get out of your glove. Regular motion there, still not a strike, but he was able to get the ball down. Right here on 3-0, just give your normal leg lift. Throw a strike here and try to get back into the count. If you're Mississippi State, it'll be interesting if you have the green light here to try to get an extra base hit with two outs.
Counting on 3-1 to Allen, sophomore from Theodore, Alabama.
He's 3-0, normal leg lift, gets the ball on the inner half of the plate. Try to do that again with a pitch in the zone and get out of the inning here and give your team a chance to get back in and score a couple runs to tie it up. Sometimes the catcher can call slide step from his position. I wouldn't call slide step the way that the first two pitches were of this at bat and want the ball down in the zone to try to get a ground ball here. And also as we look at Moose, he's also looking into the dugout. So that's coming from the dugout. It's coming from the pitching coach if he wants slide step here and then what pitch he also wants.
3-1. Lined, and that'll be foul.
Good swing, just hit the ball foul. That ball didn't really have much sink on it. It just had run.
Considering the temperature and, of course, starting in an afternoon on a work day, pretty good crowd here. A lot of maroon on the third base side of the Dr. Pepper ballpark cheering on Mississippi State. Orange splashed about cheering on Sam Houston State, and then more and more red. Whether they cheer for Texas Tech or Nebraska, to be seen. The payoff. In foul ground, but cows are under it. And that'll do it in the fifth. Mangum, a one-out single. He was left on. The star of the inning, Riley McKnight, with two sparkling defensive plays. Keeping the score at 2-0 through five. The Frisco Classic is brought to you by D1 Baseball. No one covers college baseball like D1 Baseball. Use code Frisco Classic and save 20% at D1Baseball.com. I'm excited about this. During our nightcap, Texas Tech and Nebraska, Aaron Fitt, longtime, just tremendous college baseball writer who now works for D1.com or D1Baseball.com. He'll join us, talk about Texas Tech, Nebraska, and, of course, these two teams we're seeing right now in Mississippi State and Sam Houston State. Ethan Small, his sixth inning of work. And Riley McKnight towers this behind home plate and just hitting the screen at the last second to avoid Skelton to make it an 0-1 count.
We got a first pitch out to in the fifth inning and almost a first pitch out to begin the sixth inning. Now, Ethan Small's only thrown 62 pitches in this game so far through five innings, but I just saw about four guys from Mississippi State head to the bullpen, so I don't know if this will be his last inning or not. You see the...
Counting out 1-1. And you already said it. It's cold.
Yes.
Temperatures in the 40s. This is still just the third weekend of the year. So,
yeah, third start in spring training. If this was your third start, you'd have 45 pitches.
Right. So we'll see how much Small is limited here. 1-2 now the count.
Back-to-back changeups there. And we'll see if Ethan Small, who's done a great job of elevating his fastball just above the strike zone, does that here or goes back to his changeup.
Check swing, no swing, says John Wolf.
That's where Ethan Small likes to go with two strikes if he's ahead in the count. He really likes to elevate that fastball. And when you're left-handed and tall like he is, and you can consistently throw that ball about letter high, it looks really good to the hitter because it's closer to his eyes. He can see it better, and it's a tough pitch to lay off of.
To short. Plenty of time for Westberg, and those one away.
And then Ethan Small there, he set him up after throwing the fastball up, and he got the check swing but didn't get strike three. Then he goes right back to the changeup to change the speeds, change location, and get Sam Houston State, another batter there, just out in front and able to make contact but not good contact.
So after the Bearcats loaded the bases in the third, Small has responded by retiring eight of the last nine. And Chris Lemonis just says simply, he's just a really competitive kid. He hasn't gotten into too many jams with how dominant he's been this season, but was able to keep things scoreless in the third, and his Bulldogs putting two runs in the fourth for our only run so far.
He's really gotten into a rhythm the later half of this game. Not that he wasn't in the first half of the game, but he's also...
Kowser, that will fall fair. Rounding first, Kowser takes a big turn around second, but will hold there with a one-out double.
Does a great job of hitting right there. Lefty on lefty, able to keep that front side in and shoot the ball down the left field line for a double, as you see the replay here. Ethan Small hits his spot. He hits the outer half of the plate a little bit lower, but that's just a better job of hitting there. Sometimes you have to tip your cap to the hitter, and that was a great job of hitting. So I was talking about Ethan Small now. He's going to go to the stretch here. In his windup for the last few innings, he's really kept the same rhythm, and he hasn't been doing multiple different kind of leg lifts that he was giving earlier in the game.
Hunter Hearn had three home runs in Sam Houston's opening weekend in the tournament at Stetson University in Florida. He's at the plate. Mid of the order here, Hearn batting cleanup, and the right fielder Clayton Harp is on deck.
Mississippi State playing straight up here, outfield-wise. Right fielder playing a little bit shallow. Slide step changeup. 1-0 count. Give him the quick motion and then give him something soft there. And really good job of Ethan Small pitching here. We'll see if he can get out of this situation with the runner on second and one out. You really don't have to concentrate too much on holding Kowser on too much at second base. You have a two-run lead here. You really don't want to get another guy on base. So you want to concentrate most of your concentration on the hitter, and really you want all of it. You just check the runner at second, just let him know that you know he's there, and then put all your concentration into making a quality pitch to try to get out of this inning.
Late cut, 1-2.
That after that changeup that he throws, that fastball is looking like 96 to 100 miles an hour to Sam Houston State hitters. And then after you blow a fastball by him like that, you can go back to the changeup because he had success with that pitch before. Or what Ethan Small likes doing here is he likes elevating a fastball and getting a chase.
A strikeout would be Small's seventh and Hearn's third. Bulldog fans wanted it, but it's 2-2.
Yeah, the fans might have wanted it, but that was close to a foot outside. The catcher set up outside, and then he caught it outside of his body. I've seen that in high school called a strike. But that's a tough one as the umpires also get better the further you go up. That's a tough one to get a call there.
Doug Williams right on it. Not ready for the 2-2. Good job by Hearn to work the count full.
Yeah, that was a good pitch there on 2-2. Threw a fastball down just a little bit too far down. He also slid step there, so you don't get into a rhythm of if the hitter recognizes every time in the stretch when he slide steps, he throws a changeup. So there he gives you a fastball, so you can't just sit on if he gives you a quick leg lift that it's going to be an off-speed pitch.
Counselor at second with a one-out double. Time called. Bouncer to short. Westburg to first. That'll move Couser to third, but there's two away.
Off speed there by Ethan Small. He's able to keep the ball on the ground, let his defense work for him. And Mississippi State has a great defense as Westbrook just eats up the ground ball. Easy play, two outs, runner on third. And big situation for Sam Houston State here. You'd like to get this runner home to cut it to a one-run game here. You'd love to get a whole bunch more runs. But with a runner in scoring position less than two outs, you'd love to figure out a way to get this run home.
Big hole in the middle of the infield for Harp, reigning Southland Conference hitter of the week, looking to get the Bearcats their first run. Foul off the foot.
That one always stinks a little bit more when it's colder.
Let's take another look as Harp walks that off.
Well, Hart batting 324 on the year, but lefty on 0 for 2 today, lefty on lefty. This is a tough situation here. And aggressive swing, but.
Four-year senior for the Bearcats, former Rice Bird from El Campo, Texas, about an hour southwest of Houston.
I will say, watching Harp hit today, that front foot isn't getting down quick enough to really get the right timing on Ethan Small. And, you know, Ethan Small is one of the best pitchers in the country this year. And so it's not that easy to time a lefty on lefty and then have a guy that has different motions and can throw the ball 94 with the fastball and then low 80s with the changeup. And right there you see a breaking ball that he gets over for a strike. And talked about it earlier, if you have a big leg lift, it can be harder to time guys. It can give you more power, but it can be a little bit harder to get your timing down, especially early in the year.
Harp preseason all-conference. Looks to stay alive, but a 1-2 count. A Sam Houston State team, which put up 25 runs in a sweep of Louisiana last weekend, but most of those runs coming in the late innings. Looking for a late inning rally here in the sixth. Lifted and will fall. Sam Houston State on the board. Couser scores, and it's 2-1.
Big clutch hit there for Harp. Good job of. As I was talking about, his timing was a little bit off today. He figures out a way here with a two-strike approach, two-strike count, and able to put the ball where they're not. And fastball looks like a little bit down and in, and Harp's able to get a base hit and get this game 2-1. And looks like Mississippi State, even though a run is home, is not going to get anybody up warming up yet in the bullpen.
Just the third run allowed by Small all season in 17 and two-thirds innings. Jordan Cannon singled off of Small in the fourth. He's 1-for-2. Going back, the Couser double off a ball that was low and away that he just poked into the left field corner. Is that not a bad pitch that Harp hit to score Couser?
Yeah, so far Ethan Small's hitting his spots in this inning, but Sam Houston State's doing a good job of wherever that ball is pitched, the one outside to Couser, you take the ball the other way, that one inside and able to pull your hands in and find a hole pulling the ball.
Time called.
Right now, Harp does have a big lead at first base. It's a one-way lead on a left-handed pitcher, so he knows as soon as the leg lifts, he knows if he's going to steal or he's going backwards.
Runner going. Laced up the middle off the glove of Halter. It'll trickle under center field. Harp on his way to third, and the Bearcats have runners on the corners.
That was smoked up the middle, even though Halter was able to get his glove on it. That was going to be a really tough play. He wouldn't have been there except the runner was going, and Halter was covering. But that ball was hit really, really hard.
Half of Sam Houston State's six hits coming this inning. And the tying run 90 feet away for Bonnert. Visit on the mound first. A double by Kowser, scoring on a single by Harp, and now Harp at third after the Cannon single.
I believe that in this inning, Small has thrown 20 pitches, which is by far the most pitches he's had to throw in an inning, as he's been very efficient. He had 60 or 61 pitches through five innings of this game, and you can see a little bit of fatigue now in his third start, and the ball is just not moving as much. And then also, third time through the lineup, guys have a better idea of how that fastball, how he's elevating the fastball, how he's using his changeup off of that. And this is a big kind of time to settle down for Ethan Small and get him in the right mind frame and get a big out here and get back in the dugout if you're Mississippi State.
I imagine also it's an aggressive base running team, Sam Houston State, runners on the corners, instructions on what to do if that young man, Jordan Cannon, were to take off for second base.
Yeah, and you'll see this a lot more in college baseball than you will at Major League Baseball, where there'll be times where guys steal second and stop halfway to try to get into a rundown or get the throw all the way to second base so the runner from third base can try to steal a run here.
Well, how good has this Mississippi State pitching staff been? That run by Sam Houston State we saw a minute ago, just the 17th run scored against the Bulldogs. This is game 10 for them. 8-1 coming in. But the Bearcats threatening here with a tying run 90 feet away. And now Bonnert awaiting the first pitch. He was ahead of it, 0-1.
Good changeup to start off the count there, as Sam Houston State and Mississippi State has been very aggressive at the plate early on in the count, and he used the hitter's aggressiveness against him there.
Runner going from first, and so no throw to second. Two runners in scoring position now for Sam Houston State, and the go-ahead run at second base there in Cannon.
That was big to be able to get the winning run, the go-ahead run at to second base. I was a little bit surprised there, as you had a slide step from Ethan Small. I really believed that they had a chance to throw the ball down to second base and get the out, and there's no way from third base, if the runner is going all the way to second, that if you throw the ball down and you tag them, that the runner from third can get all the way home and touch home plate before the tag is made.
Now 1-2 to Bonnert.
Good pitch from Ethan Small after the stolen base to get ahead in the count 1-2, and we've seen him do multiple things here against right-handed guys. He's gone to the changeup to get him out in front, and he's gone to the elevated fastball to strike out guys too.
Bonnert's first hit of the season came in the third. Base hit here could give his team the lead.
Two-strike approach.
Up the middle. Halter dives. Throwback to third. Not in time. The dive, though, saves potentially the go-ahead run from scoring, but the Bearcats have tied it at two as Harp scores.
It's a great at-bat, two-strike approach again that gets the job done from Bonnert, as you see him slap the ball up the middle. This is a great play to keep the ball in the infield and only allow one run. And it was a great decision to throw it to third, but a good slide there to get that left hand in just in time for Cannon to stay on base.
That's great camera work, because when the tag was applied and it was ruled safe by John Brammer over at third, there were a number of Mississippi State players. I thought that was the wrong call, but you were right on it too, Mike, seeing the replay. What a heck of a slide back by Cannon to be able to avoid that tag and keep the inning alive. Now the run would have scored anyway. It came before the tag, but now 2-2 and Moose at the plate with the go-ahead run 90 feet away.
Yeah, this is fun baseball right now, as Sam Houston State gets down in the fourth inning, and now in the sixth inning they're able to battle back and tie it up. Ethan Small's had a great game so far. This is a big situation here to try to get Mississippi State back into the dugout with a tie game.
Moose takes the first pitch. Four hits in the inning for the Bearcats out of seven overall.
And in two starts, that's all Ethan Small had given up coming into this game.
Right.
Four hits through 12 innings and 24 strikeouts, no walks. He still has not walked a guy in this game, but the Bearcats have found a way to get seven hits today.
And Yeah, Matt Deggs just says, this is a blue-collar group that works hard, and we coach them hard. And perhaps one reason why they keep their heads up even while down. Remember, I mentioned a minute ago, most of their runs, in fact, 21 of the 25 runs in the sweep of Louisiana last weekend coming in the seventh inning or later. And two here in the sixth after being down. Skelton makes the play. New ball game in Frisco. Sam Houston State puts two on the board, and we're tied at two in game one of the 2019 Frisco College Baseball Classic. New ball game here in Frisco. David Salzman, Mike Bassick with you. Sam Houston State, two in the sixth. After Mississippi State, their two runs in the fourth. First game of the 2019 Frisco College Baseball Classic, tied at two.
Well, let's see how Hayden Wisniewski here gets the new life after his Bearcats have come back and scored two in the top of the sixth. If he can have a good sixth inning here. He's thrown 73 pitches so far, five hits, the two runs given up, no walks, and four strikeouts.
Elijah McNamee last time up laced a double, which scored Tanner Allen for the game's first run. He's one for two. Foscue and Skelton to follow.
Now, this is rare for Wisniewski to fall behind in any count, but especially to start off an inning. There's nobody in the Bearcats bullpen at all loosening up. Even there's not even anybody in the bullpen. So we'll see here on 3-0 if some guys for Sam Houston State start kind of jogging down the bullpen and start stretching, as looks like Mississippi State will be bringing in a new pitcher for the seventh inning.
Count 3-1.
It's Brandon Smith warming up for Mississippi State. So most likely he'll be in for the seventh inning.
Mississippi State making it all the way to Omaha last season. Sam Houston State advancing to the Super Regionals 2 years ago. 39 wins last year, but left out of the NCAA tournament. And Matt Deggs, I can't give you the exact words he used when I asked him, is there a chip on your team's shoulder this year? But let's just say he said that, yeah, they're upset. From 3-0, McNamee strikes out on the high fastball, one away.
What a great job by Hayden Wisniewski to come back after falling down 3-0 to start the inning off, to be able to come back with three straight fastballs and get the strikeout on a fastball that really rides up and in on the hands for strike three, and a big first out to the sixth inning.
So Justin Foscue, a couple of singles and an RBI. And what a start to the year for him. He has four home runs, surpassing his total from all of last year. And then one of the big hits here today. Chris Lamona said, you know, in the fall, he didn't have a great fall, but then kind of upped his work ethic, worked really hard. And once he came back for spring practice, he has been great. He has had a productive 2019 so far, and this is just the third weekend of the year.
great breaking ball there to get strike two. You know, momentum's a real thing, especially in college sports. And you can really tell in football and in basketball, teams can go on an 8-0 quick run, and you can tell the momentum's changed. Momentum has changed in this game after the top of the sixth inning. And to be able to get a strikeout and then get an 0-2 count right now, you can hear the crowd here in Frisco, the Sam Houston State fans really getting into the game right now, feeling like they have a chance here to play with Mississippi State and possibly beat them today.
Sam Houston State led TCU Wednesday 10-3 at home in the second, but then the game called due to fog. As this is an easy play for Harp, and now two away. Reason why you bring that up is that why they were left out of last season's NCAA tournament, they frankly didn't do well enough in non-conference play. Mm. Now, the Southland is always an underrated league,
yes,
but it's not as deep as the SEC. So the Bearcats aren't going to get those RPI chances that Mississippi State's going to get all throughout SEC play. This is huge for them in hopes of, even if we look ahead to May, making the NCAA tournament. They would have loved to have that TCU game in hand, but called in the second, so not an official game. This would be huge for the Bearcats, even early in the year, with our hopes of making an at-large berth if it comes to that.
Well, I'm biased just because I'm from the state of Texas, so if I was choosing the field of 64, I would always look at a team from Texas and know that there's so much talent in the state that a team like Sam Houston State or another team from the Southland Conference is probably going to be better than a team from the Northeast that you're trying to give a bid to.
Yeah, the league's gotten deeper. Southeastern Louisiana, UNO, which made it all the way to the championship game last season, they both stepped up their games and their programs.
What a huge inning here.
Harp there. 1-2-3. Go the Bulldogs in the sixth as Wesneski does the job. Looks like we will see a new pitcher for Mississippi State. We'll tell you all about him when we return, tied at 2-6. Well, they call this tournament the best outside of Omaha, and First National Bank of Omaha is proud to be the official bank of the 2019 Frisco Classic. For all your banking needs, visit them at one of their four local branches or online at fnbo.com. You ever seen the College World Series in person?
I haven't, but my wife has really wanted to go. She's a graduate of Texas Tech who's playing later at 7 p.m. She's like, I'd love to go when Texas Tech goes. I'm like, well, the tough thing is you don't know until a week before it starts, the eight teams that are going. But I'd love to be able to have two boys and a girl. I'd love to be able to go to Omaha. It just seems awesome. I was able to play there in AAA at the old Rosenblatt Stadium, which is a lot different when you're playing AAA. There seems to be about 400 people there, and it looks like there's about 25,000 people there when it's a College World Series.
Well, there is. So I haven't been since they started playing at the new TD Ameritrade ballpark in downtown, but I went to the old Rosenblatt, and really nothing like that experience in all of college baseball. I mean, I imagine the same is true for the new ballpark, but the number of fans who go there, and of course seeing the best teams in all of college baseball, such a thrill. That's a trip you should take whether Texas Tech is there or not. Of course, Bulldogs looking to get back for the second straight year, but looking to get a win here is Sam Houston State. You mentioned, Mike, feeling the momentum after getting two in the top half of the sixth. And now a new hurler, it's Jared Liebelt, senior from Aurora, Illinois. He's the new pitcher for Mississippi State. He gets the seventh. It's his fifth appearance of the season. He has not allowed a run in 4 2/3 innings, allowing one hit and two walks. So it's Liebelt facing Diego Davila for the Bearcats on top of the order, and Mack Odom and Riley McKnight.
Now, obviously, in baseball, the pitch is just outside. You have to sit on the bench unless you're hitting that inning, and there are only three hitters that came up for Mississippi State. What Mississippi State, besides needing a run there, what they would have really liked to do is at least get two runners on to feel like the momentum shifting, something to cheer about. But giving up two runs and then going three up, three down, and a lot of credit to Hayden Wisneski, the pitcher for Sam Houston State, for doing that. Right now, there's a dugout that's feeling really good and another dugout that's saying, hey, guys, let's go, let's pick it up.
Halter to Allen, one away. So pretty incredible for all Ethan Small has done this season. 18 innings pitched. He's allowed four runs. He has not walked anybody. He has struck out 30, and yet he will still look for his first win of the year in his next start. He still will be winless and lossless. Three no decisions in his appearances.
Well, that's the tough luck of winning and losing, and that's why a lot of times you try to not put too much on that. There is something there. He did get a two-run lead in the fourth inning, wasn't able to hold on to it, but still a really good start and gave Mississippi State a chance to win here, as I believe we have a pinch hitter coming up here.
Well, it's Jack Rogers, sophomore from Spring, Texas. So he's at the top of the order now, replacing Mack Odom. Rogers, five hits and 25 at-bats, so an even 200 on the year, with three runs batted in. Two in the sixth for Sam Houston State. Two in the fourth for Mississippi State. Texas Tech and Nebraska set for a 7 o'clock first pitch tonight here in Frisco. One-one now the count.
Liebert's come in and really pumped fastballs there. 2-1 count, just a little bit off the plate. Pretty good pitch there on 1-1.
McKnight on deck. One away here in the seventh. And the count now 2-2.
Looks like good sink on that fastball. We'll see here after not throwing too many pitches so far if he comes with a secondary pitch here on the 2-2 count or sticks with the fastball location with the sink on it.
Call strike three.
Something off speed there. I'm not exactly sure. It didn't have huge break, but was able to catch the top of the strike zone for strike three.
So Sprouts Farmers Market, as we see the strikeout of Rogers. We're going to do this once a game. We have trivia.
Okay.
Here at the Frisco College Baseball Classic, and it's brought to you by Sprouts Farmers Market. Where was the first College World Series played? Was it at Rosenblatt Stadium? Just talked about it. How about Western Michigan, UCLA, or on the campus of the University of Missouri? Answer next inning.
Then I won't give you the right answer because I honestly have no clue.
Off the bat of McKnight. It took Allen off the bag and the swipe tag. He was unable to apply it as McKnight reaches base safely with two outs.
A little bit of momentum here. Let's see if we get a better replay here off the base. And it does not look like the glove moved at all, so a great call by the umpire there. And I'll tell you what, the strike zone has been great. You know, out safe on the bases. There's really been no kind of critical call that you're like, oh, I don't know if that one was the right call. The umpires have done a great job in this game.
John Wolf is right on it. It's an E4, second error of the season for Halter, his first today. And it keeps the inning alive for Kowser, who got the two-run six started with a one-out double, and he'd later score. ripped up the middle, base hit. His approach at the plate in just his third weekend playing college baseball doesn't look anything like a freshman.
No, he looks like he's been doing this for a while and confident at the plate. Mississippi State has one of the best pitching staffs in the country, and he's able to take a ball the other way against Ethan Small for a double. Then he's able to take a ball up in the strike zone and line it right back up to center field. And he's really fun to watch and should be a really fun player for Sam Houston State to have for 3 years.
I mean, that's a young man, a freshman. He bats from the left side, but that double to the left field corner, and they're just laying back and just lining that single into center. I mean, a lot of times, right, you'll see young hitters try to pull the ball too much.
They want it too much, and he's letting the ball get to wherever the pitcher wants to throw it and then taking advantage of it.
Here's Hunter Hearn. So we'll repeat how much of a late-inning team this Bearcats squad is. The 21 of their 25 runs scored last weekend against Louisiana in the seventh inning or later. And they tied this up in the sixth. But now looking for a two-out rally, which started with the error on Halter, but then the single on Kowser, keeping the inning going. Hearn looking for his first hit of the day. Big cut, 0-2.
Off speed there, and got Hearn out in front of that pitch, and that was a big pitch here. Two outs, two guys on, now 0-2 count. You can do a lot of different things. You can elevate a fastball, even though since Liebert has come in, he's more of a sinker ball fastball guy, so I don't know if he has that, you know, in his repertoire, but he's been able to strike out a guy on an off-speed pitch earlier in this inning, so see if he sinks the ball down and in or wants to throw an off-speed pitch or think about it a little bit more. And Sam Houston State, I give them a lot of credit. They have a great two-strike approach. As a team, they've done some damage with two strikes against a really good starting pitcher here today.
Coming in, they were just averaging five strikeouts a game at the plate.
Liebert feels uncomfortable with McKnight on second base, and he did have a good secondary lead there. And you want to hold him on tight because if you do make a mistake and there's a base hit, you want to give your outfielders a chance to throw him out at home plate.
Lifted right center, and it'll go all the way to the wall. McKnight and Kowser score. Hearn on his way to third as the ball gets away from the Mississippi State infield. Trying to score is Hearn, and he's tagged out. Still a two-run triple for Hunter Hearn, and Sam Houston State has stormed back to take a 4-2 lead. The leader of this Bearcat squad doing the job with the two-run triple, and Sam Houston State will lead by two as we head into the stretch. Just tried to extend it too much, but his team now up. Stretching here in Frisco, David Salzman, Mike Bastick, two in the sixth and two in the seventh, and Sam Houston State takes a 4-2 lead. Of course, both these teams would love to end their season in Omaha. And our Sprouts Farmers Market trivia question, the answer may surprise you. In 1947, the first College World Series was played in?
B.
Kalamazoo, Michigan. California, the victory over former President George Bush and his Yale squad.
Okay, but no idea.
But it happened in Kalamazoo, Michigan, And Cal, the Golden Bears, representing at the time the CIBA Conference. They were our first College World Series champs. Only eight teams even made the postseason back in 1947, four representing the East, four representing the West, and again, Cal and Yale facing off in the first ever championship game.
Dave, was all that damage done in the seventh inning with two outs and nobody on?
Yes, and the runs unearned because Riley McKnight reached base on the error by Gunnar Halter, then a Colton Cowser single, and then the two-run triple by Hunter Hearn, thrown out trying to score after the ball got away from the Mississippi State infield. So 4-2, and Wisniewski is still on the mound. How much does this surprise you?
Well, not a lot right now that he's on the mound. He does have 86 pitches coming into the inning, so now he's at 88. I was just a little bit surprised that they don't have anybody throwing in the bullpen as – Sam Houston State has taken a lead. There's nine outs to go. Wisniewski's had a great game. After that fourth inning, he's been able to put up two more zeros on the board. But we will see here. He's been able to get ahead here with a 1-2 count, trying to put away Jordan here to start off the seventh inning, and does it with a backdoor breaking ball. And not a good swing there from Rowdy Jordan, but Wisniewski's feeling great. Sam Houston State's feeling great. After being able to score the two runs in the sixth inning, I thought it was an unbelievable job by Wisniewski to go out there and to get three up, three down quickly. Great breaking ball there, as you see on the replay, for the strikeout.
And following that, since those three straight hits in the fourth, which led to Mississippi State's two runs, Wisniewski's retired 10 of the last 11. What's been the key to that?
Well, he's still getting ahead of guys, and right there you see he's keeping them really off balance. He's got the ball where it's getting back on the ground in strikeouts.
That time, that dive by Rogers, the ball gets away, and so Hayden Jones is going to be able to dive into second, and that'll be a double with one out.
And the ball's been staying on the ground. Is right there. The ball gets in the air. Let's see where this pitch is here. It's a fastball right down the middle. And good swing by Jones there to put a line drive into center field. Great effort there to try to make the play. Just missed it, and that's a tough one because missing the ball ends up getting the runner in scoring position. I would, as a pitcher, I'd rather my guy, hey, try to dive and catch that ball. If you have a chance, give a great effort, try to make a great play. If you don't, it does end up getting the runner in scoring position rather than playing it conservatively and keeping the ball in front of you.
And a correction, it was Harp now in center, moving over from right. Rogers now the right fielder, but Harp the effort, but unable to get to that baseball. And so now the tying run in the plate in Gunnar Halter, looking to make up for his error, which led to the two unearned runs by the Bearcats here in the top half of this frame.
Now, what's interesting here is there's one out, so you're not sacrifice bunting to try to get the runner to the third. But the third baseman, Kowser, is playing back. So if you are a good bunter here and a 192 batting average, you have a chance for a base hit down the third baseline. He went.
0-2, now the count.
Well, you can tell Mississippi State's fans after the double got really excited and feeling like they're trying to get momentum back on their side. And Wisniewski's been able to get right back ahead of the count 0-2. When you get 0-2, you can do so many different things.
1-2.
That usually, when you do that right there, and I've done it plenty of times, you'll see it in the major leagues done, you get 0-2 and you want to strike out and you overthrow it and you throw the ball with your body there, causes your arm to trail, and then you just get a spinning breaking ball that does nothing. He was trying to really throw his best breaking ball, but his body got too involved in the throw instead of trusting his arm and his legs to do it.
Good cut. Halter stays alive.
Got away with one there. That was belt high on 1-2. Wisniewski's done a great job of getting ahead and then putting guys away. Let's see, after kind of throwing two back-to-back bad 0-2, then 1-2 pitches, if he can throw a quality pitch here and get the second out of the seventh inning. There is a lefty lightly warming up in Sam Houston State's bullpen.
Line, base hit. Charging is Rogers. Holding at third is Jones. Tying run at first now for Mississippi State.
Another really good two-strike approach here. This one comes from Mississippi State and Halter. the bottom of the lineup and able to get to now your best players coming up in Magum and Westberg and Allen, and Sam Houston State's going to talk about it and really give guys time to probably get ready as fast as they can in the bullpen, as now there's double barrel action.
And so you mentioned how now this is the meat of the order. Now, usually you'll see 3, 4, 5 start the meat of the order for teams, but not for this Bulldog squad. Cenk Mangum, who had a single in the fifth, his 289th hit of his career, and he will be at the plate with one out and runners on the corners. Jay Sirianni, who's a Nebraska graduate, so he'll see his Bearcats face Nebraska later this weekend. He's the pitching coach and leading this conference on the mound.
Well, those last three pitches by Wesneski look like tired pitches. Look like he is at 96 pitches right now, and it looked like he was running out of steam. Now, as a pitching coach or a manager here, and you're talking to your guy, you're really trying to tell him, hey, give me everything you got for this guy. Don't think about any more, guys. I want you to give me your best stuff on this pitch and your best stuff on the next pitch. And I'm not going to allow you to fail out here. I'm going to get you out of here, but you got to give me everything you have on this one. And the reason you have to say that is because your guys aren't ready in the bullpen. They can't come in. They didn't have enough time to warm up. I just wonder if you did have a lefty ready, if you would have brought a lefty in this situation.
Cenk Mangum's career batting average coming into this year, .356. He's just below that. In 2019, as he takes the first pitch high, he's had hits in 83% of his games played. Just a star since his freshman year, and we'll mention again, a chance to be the all-time leader in hits in SEC history before his Bulldog career is over. Looking for the hit to keep the inning alive, and he strokes it into right field for a base hit. Jones scores. Deficit cut in half for the Bulldogs.
Great job. Gets a pitch that he can handle. After an elevated fastball, he lays off to get ahead in the count 1-0. And then right here, pretty much gets a fastball right down the middle and hits a hard ground ball to right field. Gets the RBI. Gets the momentum back in Mississippi State's dugout. And this is going to be big here because that was a quick base hit. That was only a two-pitch at bat. And I just don't know if the two guys that are warming up for Sam Houston State would be ready to come into the game right now. But right now I think Wesneski is running on fumes, and he's got to figure out a way. A great thing would be if you can get a ground ball here, hit to the right guy, then all it takes is one pitch to get two outs and get out of this inning.
And Riley Gossett's one of the two warming up for Sam Houston State. He is the Bearcat closer. But you said it was just a two-pitch at bat, and so Wesneski stays out to face Westberg, who's 0-3. Tapper, it'll stay fair. Tough play for Kowser, and not in time. Bases loaded.
Good pitch. Jams Westberg, but Westberg was able to get down the line and get a base hit out of a ball that in the box score tomorrow, you'll have no clue how hard or soft that ball is hit. But it is a good pitch. And there's really nothing that Kowser could do there.
Mike, the temperatures are in the 40s, and it's obvious Wesneski's getting tired, but you mentioned they're waiting perhaps to replace him. How much does this cold temperature affect how long it takes to warm up when you're in the pen?
It affects you. If this was May, you probably just need about 15 throws and you feel good, but a day like today, you probably need about 30.
And so now the bases loaded for Allen. Four straight hits for Mississippi State. Ball one.
You notice that his misses now are coming up instead of missing down. And usually with a sinker ball guy, a guy at three quarters, if their misses start elevating, it's usually a fatigue situation, as we see the first baseman playing in front of the runner, so he wants to come home on a ground ball here.
Strike call. Jones doubled. Halter singled. Mangum drove in Jones with a single. Westberg's bunt single, loading the bases here and still one out.
as now we've gotten to the triple digits of pitches, 100 pitches now for Wisniewski.
To center. Harp makes the catch. Two runners tag. Throw cut off. Bulldogs have tied the game.
Great at bat. This is a fun game. Both teams answering each other. Sam Houston State gets down by two, answers with two, takes the lead, and now Mississippi State in the bottom of the seventh is able to find a way to get two runs on the board. And we'll see if Sam Houston State wants to try to get Wisniewski one more out and get a full seven innings here.
Mangum now at third. Westberg held at first. And McNamee, with an RBI double in the fourth, steps to the plate. He's one for three.
I'll say Mangum at second base. I don't think he left early, but it was close. I would have tossed the ball back to second base, and if I was the head coach, been screaming, he left early, just to see, because it was close, to see if I can get the umpire to believe me.
But now Mangum takes his lead off third. McNamee swinging. This will send Rogers back, but now under it. He'll make the play to end the inning. Well, you said it, Mike. Both teams going at it back and forth. Both score two in the seventh, and as we head to the eighth, 4-4 in Frisco. Great one to start off the Frisco Classic, and it is owned and operated by Peak Events, providing the best outside of Omaha. Learn more at www.peak.events. Nathan Wooldridge, Ryan and Kara Holloway, instrumental in leading Peak Events and Peak Sports Management to put on this wonderful tournament now for the third season. First time we've seen Sam Houston State and Mississippi State here. The 2020 field will be announced tomorrow. Now, I know it. I can't release it.
Oh.
It's arguably the best field they've had, and they've had great fields all three seasons. That off the bat of Harp, snagged by Jordan Westberg, and quickly one out in the top of the eighth.
Well, it just matters who you're rooting for, if you're lucky or unlucky. If you're Mississippi State, this is really lucky here, as this ball's roped at 90-plus miles an hour. And if you're Sam Houston State, you're just unlucky, because if that ball can get over the head of the shortstop there, Westberg, you might have an extra base hit. That ball might get into the gap, how hard it was hit.
Jared Liebel, the second inning of work, senior from Aurora, Illinois, gave up two unearned runs last inning. Now his team rallying for two in the bottom of the seventh, and we're tied at four. The four runs are the most Mississippi State has given up in a game all year, coming in 8-1. And by the way, the four runs given up, they won 17-4 over Jackson State back on Tuesday.
Well, they'll be back in the College World Series if that ends up being their number for the year.
That off the glove of a diving Allen, and Cannon has reached with one away here.
Well, the hitters have really, on both sides, after getting off to a slow start, there's no run scored after three innings, are really starting to square up the baseball and hit the ball hard all over the park.
Rolled a hit. 10 hits now for the Bearcats in this ball game. Coming in, Mississippi State opponents were averaging 5.5 hits per contest.
Well, for Eric Bonhart, you don't want to get two strikes on him. He changes his approach and has been able to get some big two-strike hits for Sam Houston State.
Yep, couple of singles. Drove in one of the two runs in the sixth his last time up. First pitch strike. Well, last year you had big names here representing Big 12 and the SEC, but it was Louisiana Tech out of Conference USA that played the best and won 2 of 3. And here Sam Houston State, a great program, but you know, representing the Southland, maybe not the big name from the SEC or the Big 12. We've seen teams here from the Big 10 and Pac-12, but Bearcats looking for what would be their biggest win of the year. If they can rally again.
I think that's really fun in baseball is you will get to the College World Series and you'll see a team like Coastal Carolina,
right,
which you don't think too much of. And I know it happened in basketball last year with Chicago.
Loyola Chicago.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But most likely you're going to see your Kentuckys and Dukes in the Final Four. And when it comes to college football, you're never going to see a team that's not in one of those Big Five conferences or Notre Dame in your championship or Final Four now that they have. Type of situation. But in baseball, you'll see teams like a Sam Houston State be able to have a great year and make it to the College World Series.
Sam Houston State advancing to the Super Regionals for the first time in their history 2 years ago, and they did it by winning back-to-back games in Lubbock over Texas Tech. Those two teams have not played since, and they will on Sunday. Here
or
in Frisco.
Will they?
weather permitting. It's supposed to be even a little colder Sunday, but you can always hope. 1-2 the count to Bonnert.
Well, they have Bonnert in a good situation, I would say, with one ball and two strikes, but the way that he changes his approach, he chokes up, and then he kind of goes into, I don't know if you remember, Tony Batista a little bit, the way he holds his hands out there and is able to slap the ball for base hits today. So his two-strike approach has been better than his other approaches.
Runner going. This playable and foul ground for Allen. And there's two outs.
Good job by Cannon there to hear his coaches. And you could hear the dugout there screaming back as soon as the ball was hit since he was going on the pitch to be able to get back and keep the inning alive with two outs.
Gavin Johnson will pinch hit now for Sam Houston State, senior from San Antonio. Hitting 409, and that is best on the Bearcats coming in. He started 5 games this season, though getting the day off until now. 9 hits and 22 at-bats on the year with a home run.
Probably because Ethan Small, the starting pitcher for Mississippi State, is so good, and also being left-handed, saving him for a righty later in the game. And he might not get to face a righty later in the game. He might have to face a left-handed pitcher.
Conference on the mound first. With Sam Houston State, a runner on first. And the Bulldogs will make a pitching change. Bulldogs led 2-0. Bearcats led 4-2 until the Diamond Dogs rallied for 2 in the seventh. And Mississippi State looking to keep the score as is. We'll tell you about their new hurler when we return.
Outside of Omaha.
for Mississippi State, left-hander number 46, Tristan Barlow.
For Mississippi State, 6'1 lefty junior from Halls, Tennessee. It's his fourth appearance of the season, 0-1 with an ERA of 2.70. Two outs, top of the eighth. Runner on first for Sam Houston State in a 4-4 tie. As Gavin Johnson facing Barlow, lefty on lefty, and it's an 0-1 count.
It was a tough situation for Johnson to come in on, but hey, it's late in the game, tie game. Try to figure out a way to get a hit as Barlow looks like he has really good stuff when he was warming up. Looked like he was throwing a hard fastball and then off of that a hard slider. You might even want to call it a cutter. It didn't have tons of break, so he might just be more of kind of a fastball cutter type of guy out of the bullpen.
Stand at 6-1, 215. Runner going. It's a strike, but the ball gets away from Skelton, and so the Bearcats with a runner in scoring position.
And there's the off-speed pitch there, the slider that looked like it was going to be on the outer half of the plate and then just goes down and away in the dirt. But big stolen base there for Sam Houston State. Now it's two strikes, so it's going to be tough to get a hit, but if you can get a hit, you can take the lead here.
Johnson, four RBIs this season, nine hits, 22 at-bats, and a 409 average. Looking to give his team its second lead.
Sam Houston State with that two-strike approach with the hands out towards the pitcher. There's the breaking ball on the outer half. Pretty good try right there. Probably wanted a little bit lower, but good try.
Runner on second. It is Cannon. That's foul. Matt Diggs calls Gavin Johnson a banger. Just one of those guys that can make contact, hard to get out. Looking to give his team the lead potentially with a base hit.
You know, I've never seen that approach. And Sam Houston State, a lot of their guys, not all of their guys, but with two strikes, take their hands and they put them towards the pitcher and then just bring them back quietly and then just try to really slap the ball for a line drive and try to find a hole.
Johnson does it here, pulls back, and lines that pitch foul.
That's a good breaking ball right there. This is going to be tough because Barlow looks like he has pretty good stuff and probably their go-to lefty in big situations and throws the ball hard and then has the breaking ball to go with it. Barlow's hanging in there, trying to hope that there's a mistake here, that Johnson, you know, finds a mistake here and is able to put the ball in play hard and find a hole. If you want to steal third, you can. They're not even going to hold on here with two strikes.
In the dirt. Lob throw to first in time, and Tristan Barlow keeps the game tied at four. Bearcats in this contest have left five runners in scoring position. Still tied up as we take a break.
Lumberlandco.com and check out amazing handcrafted durable bat mugs.
Lumberland Co. is a proud sponsor of the Frisco College Baseball Classic, home of the original bat bug. Again, that's lumberlandco.com. Do you own a pair of the best cowboy boots in the world? Well, if you don't, you're in luck, because Lucchese Bootmaker has a store right down the road at the Star in Frisco. Stop by to shop Western and Contemporary boots and footwear, or browse them online at lucchese.com.
David Salzman, former Major League pitcher Mike Masick with you. Frisco College Baseball Classic. We are in the heart of the Dallas-Fort Worth area in the third year for this great event. Four great teams, two who made it to the College World Series last season. For the first time, Sam Houston State will go to their bullpen, and it's Riley Gossett, 6'1 junior from Cypress, Texas, in the Houston area. Gossett with one of the team's two saves this season. He has not allowed a run in 5 1/3 innings of work, allowing four hits and one walk while striking out three. First pitch lined, and that's a fair ball. It's off the bat of Justin Foscue, rounding first and on his way to second, his third hit of the day in the Bulldogs, with a runner in scoring position to begin the eighth.
Well, Mississippi State and Justin Foscue was not waiting to see what the pitcher had. He gets a fastball up right down the middle. Line drive right down the line. And that's one thing as a reliever you have to know, just watching Mississippi State today and also Sam Houston State. They're not going to see what you have. You throw a pitch and it's close to the zone, they're going to swing. And so to try to get into a rhythm and just get that first pitch over out of the bullpen can hurt you, as Mississippi State's dugout having some fun.
Conference on the mound, and we'll see if this is the only man that Gossett will face. There is activity in the Bearcat bullpen.
That'd be tough to throw one pitch and then to say, oh, that's good, we'll go to somebody else. I know the major leagues are trying to propose a rule that won't happen in 2019, but if you come out of the bullpen, you have to face a minimum of three hitters.
Which I wouldn't like that rule at all.
I'm not crazy about that either, just because if you think about it, in the eighth inning with two outs and the base is loaded and you bring in your setup guy and he gets out of that, that means he has to close the game. You can't bring in your closer now for the ninth inning. And so I get what they're trying to do to speed up the game, that you don't have as many pitching changes. But I think once you get into that eighth inning, there can be so many situations where you have to use multiple guys. But there's a lot of what I call casual baseball fans that complain about the time of the game. And look, I have to do a lot of Texas Ranger games. They can take a while. But at the same time, you don't want to take away the strategy of the game just to make the game a little bit faster.
Strategy would actually be to start the games a half hour earlier. I mean, if you're not there, do you want to be there for the beginning of the game or the end of the game?
Yeah.
I'd rather be there for the end.
Yeah.
All right, Dustin Skelton looking for his first hit. Bunts.
Perfect.
And Bearcats are going to wisely let that ball go. And you said it was perfect initially. I thought first it was going to stay fair as well, but just trickled outside that third base line.
Once it caught the lip of the grass and then it got that downward towards the dirt, you can see the grass is always usually going to be higher than the dirt. It's going to go good. And then it catches the grass and then gets to that dirt and then pushes it foul. But that was going to be a base hit. That, I know he wasn't trying to get a hit, but Dustin Skelton was going to get a base hit out of that bunt if it stayed fair.
And Gavin Johnson, now the catcher, is a heck of a job because by instinct it looks like he wanted to pick it up, and that last second you saw him pull back. Not missed, one and one.
So you saw right there on the replay, the shortstop sneak back behind the second baseman. That was a design play. Don't think that the pitcher messed up there. They were trying to pick at second base. They're trying to have the runner at second base there, Foscue, not get a secondary lead at all, almost run back to second base. So even if it's a good bunt, that there's the third baseman staying at his position.
That's in there for a strike.
The key here as a pitcher is if they're going to bunt here with one and two, and then it's going to be a tough one because you bunt it foul, it's a strikeout, is you got to take a little bit of a deeper angle because you want that third baseman to hang a little bit closer to third base. So if you feel that there's a chance that you can throw it to third and tag Foscue running, because this is late in the game here, if Mississippi State can score this run, they have a great chance of winning.
Good stop by Gavin Johnson. And again, this is just his first inning behind the plate.
Yeah, that was not easy, and that was a game-saving block right there because that gets the bunt done right there if you don't block that ball. And to block it so soft that it stays in front of you, that ball wasn't just right over home plate. It was a foot outside and short.
To short, and it gets by the shortstop, Davila. Rounding third, coming in to score is Foscue, and the Bulldogs take the lead.
Well, the Bulldog fans are excited. Dugouts pumped up for Mississippi State. Put pressure on the freshman shortstop, and we'll see here. It might have taken a bad hop there in the end. There's a grounder, two hopper, and just gets on the heel of the glove there, the palm, top part of the glove, and the ball gets kind of into shallow center field.
Rolled an A6, and so the Bulldogs have rallied with two in the seventh and one in the eighth after being down two to take a 5-4 lead. Off the bat of Jordan, Bonnert makes the catch for the first out.
Good job there by Bonnert to get the ball back in quickly to second base. So Skelton couldn't tag there. But once again, Mississippi State was not going up to see what the pitcher had. They were going up to swing the bat. If you throw it close, they're going to swing.
If you're a Bearcat fan, don't lose hope yet. You're top of the order, due up in the ninth. But Sam Houston State wanting to keep this a 5-4 game. And Jay Sirianni, the pitching coach for the Bearcats, will go to the bullpen. We'll tell you about the new Bearcat hurler when we return with the Diamond Dogs up one.
The Frisco Roughriders begin their 2019 season here at Dr. Pepper Ballpark on April the 4th, just 34 days away. And single game tickets are now on sale. So make sure to visit the ballpark box office tonight and all weekend long to get your spot. Plenty of great games on tap this summer, including tons of fireworks shows, theme nights, giveaways, and more. All weekend long, we're supporting the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation here at the Frisco Classic. As you know, the CF Foundation is one of the leaders in searching for a cure. That's why we need your help, though. Make sure to donate at concession stands throughout the ballpark and visit the table at section 119 for more information on all the great things the CF Foundation is doing.
standing in one spot like I am.
The Frisco Classic brought to you by Sprouts Farmers Market. Visit your local Sprouts today or learn more at sprouts.com. Stephen Beard, new pitcher for Sam Houston State. Southpaw is a true freshman from the Woodlands, Texas, just north of Houston. It's his fifth appearance of the season. He's allowed two runs in three innings of work and has a record of 1-0.
Well, this is a big situation here that you want to keep the game 5-4, because with 5-4, you just get a runner in scoring position, a base hit, you can tie the game. You get a big bop and you get a ball over the fence, you tie the game. If it becomes 6-4, obviously it makes it a lot more challenging to tie up the game or to take the lead in the top of the ninth.
So both these teams coming in playing sparkling defense. Bearcats just 9 errors in 7 games, and Mississippi State just 5 errors in 9 games, but fielding miscues have played a big part in the runs we've seen late. Both of Sam Houston State's runs in the seventh unearned gave them a 4-2 lead. And then the error on the shortstop, Diego Davila, allowing Foscue to score this inning, which right now is the go-ahead run.
Yeah, and that was a tough play for Davila as he kind of got a hop that was a tough one to handle there. But, hey, it happens. It happens in the major leagues. Every play's not made. And now if the ball's hit to you, make a clean play, make a double play, get in the dugout, and maybe you get up in the next inning and have a big at-bat to tie the game up or to take the lead.
Pinch hitter will face Beard and Marshall Gilbert, senior from Kenosha, Wisconsin. 5 hits and 10 at-bats for Gilbert this season, including a home run.
Always find it interesting when a person from Kenosha, Wisconsin, maybe not the city of Wisconsin, that city, but Wisconsin finds his way to Mississippi State.
He comes by way of John Logan Community College. Now playing in Starkville when they play their home games at what they call the new Dude, Duty Noble Stadium, which has just been renovated and one of the palaces in all of college baseball. Skelton reaches second, running on the pitch, and the count now 1-1.
Yeah, good off-speed pitch there, but in the dirt with a runner going, and you get another guy in scoring position with less than two outs for Mississippi State. So big at-bat here for Gilbert. Pinch hit here to try to get an RBI and extend the lead to 6-4.
Two and one.
It looks like when I'm looking at the pitcher on the mound right now, Stephen Beard. Like, is he a freshman in college or a freshman in high school? That's a very young-looking man on the mound. He's a freshman here, but he might be able to pass for a 15-year-old in the face. Or I'm just getting really old.
Well, I was about to say, is it him or us? Because yes. I know, college freshmen are the same age, but we aren't, right? Year after year.
No, I know. I'm 41 now. I'm like, man, he doesn't look 19 years old. But
by Beard, having to charge McKnight in a nice play to get Gilbert at first, moving to third is Skelton.
That's three great plays by McKnight in this game. A ground ball up the middle he was able to make a nice play on, a pop-up in foul territory, a sliding catch, and now a slow roller where he's able to charge. And it's always a tough throw from a second baseman as you're making the angle tougher and tougher the further in you have to go. But nice play, two outs, and we'll see if Stephen Beard gets to face Halter, and I don't think he will.
Once again, Sam Houston State goes to the pen. Once again, we'll take a timeout. Bearcats looking to keep this deficit at just a run.
jackets, hats, blankets, more, all waiting for you at the Riders Outpost Team Store, located next to the home plate gate here at the ballpark. Stop by today and get geared up for the new season ahead. Now pitching for the Bearcats, right-hander number 41, Cole Wesneski.
Starter for Sam Houston State today was Hayden Wesneski. His brother Cole now is on in relief. Sophomore transfer from Cypress, Texas, by way of Navarro College in Corsicana, Texas. And Wesneski's numbers are good. 2 1/3 innings of work. He has not allowed a hit and has just walked one, not allowing a run.
Well, his brother had a great start for Sam Houston State. Let's see if younger brother can finish this out and get Sam Houston State in the dugout in just a one-run game.
Gunnar Halter singled and scored in the seventh. That tied the game. And, of course, Mississippi State taking the lead. Justin Foskey leadoff double, scoring on an error by the shortstop Diego Davila. Runner on third is Dustin Skelton. That's foul.
Saw the hitter there, Halter. He stopped running because it was foul and then noticed that Sam Houston State wasn't going to touch it since he wasn't running, just to see if it had trickled back fair. And then he took off running, and then third baseman Kowser ended up going and touching the ball to stop the play.
Hits are even at 10, both teams with two errors.
Good breaking ball there to get ahead in the count 1-2. After that swing there, I would repeat that pitch. Try to get it maybe a little bit lower, but want to repeat that pitch right there with that swing that you just saw.
Just got a piece to stay alive.
Yeah, he repeated it, and he was able to foul it off. So now you can do it a third time. That wasn't a great swing, but it was a better swing than the 1-1 that we saw. Or you can try to possibly, after throwing too soft, go hard inside here. I think he's going to go back to that breaking ball.
Right side. McKnight makes the play, and that'll do it. An unearned run gives the Diamond Dogs the lead. 5-4 Mississippi State. Perhaps three outs away from opening the 2019 Frisco College Baseball Classic with a victory. If the Bearcats are to rally, they have to do it against one of the best pitchers in all of college baseball, Cole Gordon, 6'5" graduate from Tampa, Florida, a 20 2/3 inning scoreless streak after two scoreless innings against Southern Miss back on Sunday. That streak began in the 2018 NCAA Regional in Tallahassee and remains intact as he looks to hold up this 5-4 lead and give Mississippi State a victory to begin their weekend here in Frisco.
Well, what'll be interesting here is can Sam Houston State be patient, because in the five innings, Cole Gordon has four walks, eight strikeouts. He can strike you out, but there is a chance that you can get yourself into a hitter's count or get a free pass.
It'll be Chase Cryer, the pinch hitter, to face Gordon first. 1-0 the count.
Now, has there been a walk in this game?
There has not been a single walk in this game yet.
Okay.
Both teams do have 10 hits. Cryer is 2-for-14 entering this pinch hitting role with 3 runs scored this year. Pop back foul.
I always wonder, once you graduate, are you just taking classes still, or do you just get to show up for baseball?
And still got to take classes.
Okay.
Boy, that'd be nice. If you could graduate and then only play baseball and that's it, be like being a minor leaguer.
Yeah. Good breaking ball there to get ahead in the count 1-2. That's always tough on 1-1 here, as you see the breaking balls, the guy's throwing in the mid-90s, and then you have the 12-6 curveball. And now you're behind in the count, how you're going to try to put the ball in play.
Call strike three.
It looked like on that one, Cryer didn't get ready to hit. I know he had his hands out in front. It looked like he didn't bring his hands back fast enough. See how his hands had to come back really quick? I think he loaded late and wasn't able to even try to foul off the good breaking ball there from Gordon Cole.
So top of the order now, Jack Rogers. 0-for-1 came on as a pinch hitter in the seventh. Riley McKnight is on deck. And arguably the Bearcats' best hitter, Colton Kounzer, in the hole now, batting third in the order. 1-0 count.
This is one right now. The radar gun is not turned on here at the ballpark. I'd love to see what Cole Gordon is throwing, because it looks like it's coming out of his hand pretty firm.
Strike call.
Good location, low and away. The one thing here is the ball's probably not going to carry that great as it's really cold here today, but you don't want to throw a ball down the middle and see how far Jack Rogers can hit it, because he can tie up the game with one swing.
Now, Cole Gordon is showing off his entire repertoire so far.
It's been the same. It's been fastball, fastball, breaking ball, and then breaking ball for a strikeout. This has been fastball, fastball, breaking ball, 1-2 count, as we see the 12-6 curveball. He got the K on a breaking ball on 1-2. Let's see if he does it again.
One of the outside corner there, like he did against Cryer.
Yeah, same sequence, but that one ended up staying outside as Mississippi State's coach was asking the catcher there where that pitch was, but it was outside. From the dugout, you can't tell inside and outside that well.
Lifted, base hit. Rogers fights it off for a one-out single.
I tell you what, both of these teams have been fighting and battling this whole game. Both these teams have good pitching staffs. And to figure out a way there with two strikes to get on base and to give your team a chance is great, as we have a pinch runner here.
Darian Sims is the pinch runner. Senior from Spring, Texas, representing the tying run. And so here's McKnight. He's looking for his first hit. He's reached base twice, but on an error in the seventh, and he would later score, and he was hit by a pitch in the third. 0-for-3 so far today. And 2-of-17 on the year. Looking to get out of his early season funk at the plate.
Big lead. If you have quick feet here, if that lead is going to be the same by Sims, I would pick back over there again and give my best move. And if you can give a throw about knee high, to your first baseman, Allen. You have a chance to pick him.
Sims with a couple of stolen bases this year. Quick throw, and Sims is back in.
And Sims knows how far he can get off. Obviously, this is one of the things that he does for Sam Houston State. He comes in and pinch runs and gets stolen bases, a good, healthy lead, and was able to get back in time. So he's going to get another big lead here, and I expect in the first two pitches here, one of the first two, for him to try to steal second base.
Check swing. No swing, says John Wolf over at first. All right, 1-0, and so you said the first two pitches.
I'm going to say here, and you see that ball was outside. It was close, but it was outside, and McKnight was able to hold up. I think he's going to go here. Now he has a shorter lead. Sometimes that's a tip-off. Let's see if he gets a bigger lead once Cole comes set. He stays there. It's a little bit less of a lead. He was going.
It was late getting back to first and just got there in time.
It's a bad throw. If it was a better, harder throw, he had him. He was going. That's the thing, being a left-hander, I can see that. Being a right-hander, you can't. He had a different lead. And when you have a different lead, and I can see it as a left-hander, right-hander, you can't. It tips you off to something's different here.
Right now, he still has that short lead, and he doesn't go. And this is lifted to right. McNamee had to take another acceleration towards the ball. He wasn't under it as he thought he was initially, but still able to make the grab, and now there's two away.
Yeah, that ball carried a little bit more than he thought there.
Well, how about this? One of the best freshmen in all of the nation in Colton Cowser, couple of hits and runs scored his last two times up. Looking to at least keep the inning alive, if not break the scoreless streak of Cole Gordon with two outs in the ninth.
Good lead. Got him.
Again late. They got him. That'll do it. The pickoff of first and Mississippi State opens the 2019 Frisco Classic with a 5-4 victory.
Boy, what a great job by Mississippi State and by Cole Gordon right there. Sims got the big lead. He was running first pitch there. He took off. He had that false step towards second and was able to get a pickoff, which you kind of rarely see to close out a game. But great game by both sides. This was a really fun opener to the Frisco Classic here.
It was back and forth, scoreless until the bottom of the fourth. Mississippi State getting the game's first two runs. Bearcats with two in the sixth, two in the seventh to take the lead. But then Mississippi State would rally with two in the seventh and an unearned run in the eighth. And they knock off Sam Houston State by a score of 5-4. Team ranked as high as ninth in the nation improves to 9-1.
Yeah, this is going to be a fun weekend here in Frisco, as Sam Houston State has shown early on in the season they can compete against the big schools. And Mississippi State was able to find a way after falling behind 4-2 to tie it up in the bottom of the seventh, find a way to score in the bottom of the eighth and get a win. Really fun baseball. Both starting pitchers, Ethan Small and Wisniewski, great games.
Just the first of two we'll have for you today. Come back in about an hour, 7 o'clock. Texas Tech, ranked number 3 in the nation, to take on the Nebraska Cornhuskers. For Mike Bassick and our entire Flow crew, I'm David Salzman, saying so long from the Frisco College Baseball Classic. For now, Sam Houston State falling to Mississippi State by a score of 5-4.